Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
It's kind of caught us off guard. Tonight is not really the public hearing night for a budget, but we're going to work with that the best we can. But before we start our meeting, I'm going to ask Commissioner Sutton if he would do our invocation and pledge.
If we could take a moment, please. Our Heavenly Father, thank you for letting us be able to come together and participate in one of the greatest freedoms of any free people in the world, self-governance. And also, with my invocation, freedom of religion. Be with us as we conduct the county's business. Help us to be good citizens, pro or con, as far as the issues go. Help us be willing to talk, debate, discuss in a gentle, ladylike manner, and accept the good processes of our government, whether you agree with our decisions or not. Please be with our government. Please be with the world and other countries and their governments as we face some of the most daunting times in the history of mankind. Help everybody come together as governments should and as good leaders should and discuss what it's going to take to keep peace at hand rather than war. Amen. We could address the flag, please.
I'll pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, this is the time we normally do our public speakers, but due to the number of folks here, our rules basically say that we have 30 minutes and a maximum of three people to address any one subject, but I think Ms. Galey is going to make a motion for me, and if the board's in agreement, we will extend that time.
I do. I have a motion to make. The public comment policy of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners, number one, says that the comment period should be limited to a maximum of 30 minutes. Number two includes the item that there will be no more than three speakers on any one topic per meeting. In light of the number of citizens who have come out tonight to raise their opinions about our budget this year, I would make a motion to suspend the public comment policy with regards to those two factors, so that we would be able to have more than three speakers on any one topic. And I would amend policy number one, that instead of the comment period being limited to a maximum of 30 minutes, that it be for 60 minutes.
I second the motion.
Okay, thank you, Amy. Thank you, Bob. Everybody's in agreement?
Yeah.
All right, then that's where we're going. Dr. Harrison has done me a favor here, and would you like to speak first, sir?
I would.
Yes.
Commissioners, I appreciate you amending the policy to allow a few other folks to have their comments. I think even though we're going to have more than three people speaking to the budget, you're going to see multiple perspectives, and I appreciate all those who have come out to address you on behalf of our budget. And really, it's not a budget. As I said last time, this is an investment. There's no better investment that a community can make than in its children and its public schools. Public schools define a community. Public schools are economic development. We've been very intentionally working towards our vision that was adopted in 2013-2014. Many citizens worked towards that vision. Our staff, prior to my arriving, did a masterful job of coming up with a strategic plan to make that vision a reality. We have very intentionally and explicitly built our budget around that strategic plan the last 3 years. In 2014, I came before this board and presented an idea of what it would cost to implement that budget fully that plan fully was a rather large amount, and said that would not be a reasonable request by any stretch of the imagination. And we tried to get a good start on that. What would be a reasonable start that could let us move towards that vision in earnest, but also respect all the responsibilities and the obligations that you have as the Board of Commissioners. I think that we've done a good job of staying true to that vision. I think we have some numbers that show that we are making progress. We're not going to get where we want to be overnight. After the last budget hearing, we have posted, I think just last week, a little more information on our markers, our targets, and the progress that we are making towards those. Shannon Dennison, our finance officer, sent to Susan and Brian today something showing what our inflationary costs would be, and we had some conversations about those inflationary costs when I was before you last time, that those are simply costs that we incur as a result of action of the General Assembly. We built that budget around a 2% salary increase. What the Senate has proposed is a 3.75 salary increase for teachers, which is good, but ends up costing us a little more. I'm not going to go through those numbers, but it's about $1.6 million for us to hold our own, to simply not cut anything next year, but also not move forward on our strategic plan. We're committed to our teachers. We have in the neighborhood of 1,800 teachers that are out there doing yeoman's work each and every day for our kids. We have 36 principals that are providing the type of leadership that teachers and children deserve. We have essential services staff that is as lean as they can be, that I think provides support to our schools. So I ask you to think about and reflect about what you would like your legacy to be. It's tough decisions that you need to make, but the good decisions, the valuable decisions when we truly move forward, that's always tough. It's easy for me to stand in front of you or come up with a budget asking a lot of money, but I appreciate your consideration. Thank you so much for the support in the past.
Thank you, sir. Okay, next, Stephen Gray. We may have to wait a minute because they may be in the back.
Yep.
Okay, so it's a pleasure to be able to address you today, and I appreciate you hearing my comments. I'm coming here as a citizen of Mebane and also a parent of two children in the school system. I think the point that I want to make today is, first of all, I appreciate the wonderful job that all of you have done to encourage a lot of positive growth in the county, and especially positive growth in Mebane. I've lived here 10 years. I work in Chapel Hill, and I've seen a lot of positive things happen over the last 10 years. But here lately, I've been very concerned about some of the developments with the schools, and one of the things that I've noticed is already overcrowding in some of my children's schools. Mebane's projected to grow by quite a lot, probably 50% over the next 5 years. That's the projections that I've seen from the City Council. And we have a problem now, and it's only going to get worse. And if we don't deal with this problem now, it's going to become worse. And I'll say, when I moved here 10 years ago, working in Chapel Hill, I chose to live in Mebane because it was affordable and because it had very good schools. If there aren't good schools, there is no way that I'd live there. And looking at our neighboring city of Graham, their county commission, or sorry, their city council came to some of the school board meetings with a concern that their growth was being restricted because they needed more investment in their schools. And so what I'll say is we're enjoying a lot of positive growth right now. There's a lot of really good things happening. But if we don't address the schools and invest in the schools right now, this will become a bigger problem than any of you will be able to deal with, I think. And you won't enjoy any of this growth that's happening, this positive growth, because no one's going to want to live in a city like Mebane if the schools aren't up to par. I'll keep it short so that others can speak, but that's really the concern that I have. I'm happy with my children's education now. I'd like it to be better, but we'll be in the school system for a while, and I want it to stay good. So I appreciate you listening to me.
Thank you very much. Okay, next, John Charles Steele and Job Williamson.
Yeah.
And I guess he's in the back. Good evening, guys.
Good evening. My name is Joe Williamson, and this is John Charles Steele, and we are rising seniors at Walter Williams High School. We would like to speak to you today about the budget for our school system. ABSS is made up of approximately 23,000 students from PK to 12th grade. There are people-centered business tasks for education for our young people. This costs money, and 90% of the funds that we get from federal, state, and local money goes to pay for the employments of our teachers and their benefits. If the state raises teachers' pay, why don't Alamance County do the same thing? Using local funding to make up this difference, we have already heard that the state, the elementary class size will be reduced from a plus, which is a plus for us, and it requires also 10 teachers with no state funds. It will have to come from the local money. Teachers, administrators, and ABSS get a supply, which needs to be increased by 1%, so that our salaries will line up with those of neighboring counties. If not, we could lose great teachers in our county and great administrators to other counties that can pay more. We also need to ensure that our faculties are sound and have the capability to serve all of our students. It is essential to good learning for our schools and equipment are well maintained in good working order. This can only be achieved by funding most, if not all, of the budget of ABS sets forth.
Thank you.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I'm John Charles Steele. First, I'd like to apologize for not being as finely dressed as Joe because I just came from football practice. But second of all, I'd like to talk to y'all about money. The proposed increase of 6 cents per every $100 of tax dollars would fund this budget. And what would you get for those tax dollars? You'd get programs such as Global Passport, A-plus Arts, Leader in Me, STEAM, SPLASH, the International Baccalaureate Program, a Fire Academy, ABSS Early College, Pre-Collegiate Academy, and the ABSS Virtual Academy, to name a few. These specialized programs are designed to meet a few students' needs and interests and provide a variety of rigorous learning options and opportunities for world-class education. What is a world-class education? This is an education that has global as well as local perspective. It sets you apart and affords you the chance to grow and achieve at the next level of education and in life. It gives you the tools to better yourself, thus bettering the world around us. We have gotten a world-class education, and we want to see the younger generations build on this and progress even farther. By providing these opportunities, such as the programs I mentioned, we are giving future students in ABSS a chance at a world-class education. The 23,000 students that Joe mentioned are the hope of this county. Each of these students has the potential to impact multitudes of lives, and imagine the positive result if all of these students had the shot at a world-class education like me and Joe have. Money isn't always the answer. On the other hand, we will never know that what good or extraordinary things might occur unless new ideas are put in place on the promise of faith and the desired outcome. Invest in your future. Invest in my future. Invest in Alamance County future. Please fund the proposed ABSS budget. Thank you, and please consider what I've said.
Thank you. All right. While they're leaving, Laura Clemens.
Good evening, Commissioners Boswell, Byrd, Gailey, Lashley, and Sutton. My name is Laura Clemens, and my husband and I live at 4668 Freedom Drive in the village of Alamance. We are the parents to these three children who are students in the ABSS system. Zach is a freshman at Southern High School, Lily is a sixth grader at Southern Middle, and Katie is a second grader at Highland. I have been a public school teacher for 29 years and have taught in Alamance County since 2004. First, I want you to know I realize how difficult your jobs are, and that most likely every one of you would fully fund all of the county requests if you felt the funds were available and the requests necessary. I sincerely thank you for your hard work and the sacrifices you make in representing the citizens of this county. Second, while I recognize there are many requests from county departments and that ABSS's request is much larger than in previous years, I am here to advocate for you to fully fund their budget request. 3 years ago, when the Strategic Plan Visioning Committee, which my husband was part of, was formed, their work produced a document that clearly stated the time was now to demand the very best from our public school system. They asked, why not us? Why not have the best public school system in the state? And as you know, what followed was the development of a comprehensive strategic plan that sets the goals and pathway that may lead directly to that accomplishment. If the strategic plan is fully funded and courageously acted upon, I believe we will provide the very best for our children in terms of public education, and our county will be stronger economically and socially. We will have an educated workforce that is skilled and ready for the changing demands of employment in the future. We will have children who will become adults with dreams of success and a real roadway that will take them there. My career as a public school teacher is coming to a close in the near future. But as I reflect on my life in public education, I am proud of the work that my colleagues and I have done. But I know that more could have been accomplished had all of us, and by this I mean all of our county citizens, focused more of our financial resources and energy on being the best that we can be in education. I have watched too many young teachers and administrators leave the profession or leave our county to work in other systems because they didn't believe they had the support or financial ability to remain. I have seen how overcrowded some of our schools are and have wondered if their students are truly able to achieve all they can because of space limitations. I have seen too many local cuts made to positions and programs because of lack of funding. I have seen our facilities deteriorate because as a system, we couldn't financially keep up with the repair and maintenance of buildings built many years ago. The list could go on. There is one thing, however, I know and believe. We are only as good as we can be when we commit to educating every child in this county. From Snow Camp to Pleasant Grove, from Elon to Mebane, from West Burlington to East Burlington, and everywhere in between. As a county, we have to financially support the schools adequately in order to accomplish that. If we get this right, then you all will be celebrated in the future as courageous leaders willing to partner with the school system that has a vision and a plan. Are you willing to take that step? As a citizen and a constituent, I hope so. Again, I thank you for your time and your commitment to the citizens of Alamance County.
Thank you. Tara Regeth. And others.
Hey, I'm Tara Raggett. These are my Supremes.
All right.
This is Candy and Hannah. We represent the first, second, and third teacher leadership cohort. We're here advocating for the 400 students we teach at North Graham Elementary. I got my 3-minute speech. I appreciate the 3 minutes. I'm addressing the commissioners this evening first and foremost as an Alamance County citizen and taxpayer. My perspective on the budget is unique due to the variety of roles I play for Alamance Burlington Schools. I'm a parent, coach, and teacher. As a taxpayer, I want a thriving community which invests in its schools, the physical buildings, and more importantly, the students, the future citizens of Alamance County. I want to ensure we are attracting businesses that want to plant roots, invest, and grow in Alamance County, making it a stable and prosperous community. As a parent, I want well-maintained schools which are aesthetic, welcoming, and in top working condition. I want my children to attend schools with specialized programs which give them a unique education experience and an edge when competing for jobs, scholarships, and college acceptances. I had the great fortune of helping to coach the Southern Alamance women's soccer team to the third round of the state playoffs, better known as the Sweet 16. Our girls traveled to a variety of schools, as close as Cedar Ridge and Page, and as far away as West Johnston, Panther Creek, Porter Ridge, and Mooresville. Playing at these schools has shown me the reality as to how our stadiums, fields, locker rooms, and outdoor facilities are outdated, unmaintained, and at times not safe. My daughter, an honor student who was a member of that team, summed it up best. You think our facilities are fine until you travel and realize everything we use is old and broken down. We are not competitive. I'm a teacher at North Graham, one of only 50 schools in the state which has competed for and earned the status of an A-plus art school. This specialized program gives our students a unique quality education experience which many counties cannot provide for their students. This specialized program was best showcased with our production of The Lion King. It required our students to be innovative, think critically, problem solve, and collaborate. These are the soft skills Alamance County businesses have been stating they need from job applicants. Any school can show you a measurable test score in order to make you feel warm and fuzzy about the quality of a student's education. Our A-plus program goes above and beyond by having our students to take their context knowledge, combine it with soft skills, and complete a real-world task. At the end of the day, that is the objective of a specialized program, because that is what employers are requiring from job seekers. I stand before you as a taxpayer advocating for 22,000 people in this county who were not asked about an increase in taxes, but whose future depends upon it. I want to pay more in taxes to ensure ABSS is competitive in all facets of education. In 1985, our tax rate was 54 cents. Today, it's 58 cents. We're trying to keep up with 21st century growth and maintain 60-year-old buildings with a 32-year-old tax rate. It's time to sell the LaCar, throw away the members-only jackets, and move forward with a competitive tax rate. If not, one day, one of our 22,000 students is going to ask you why you viewed their education as unnecessary and unmeasurable burden, a bottomless pit, instead of a necessary investment in their development as a productive Alamance County citizen. Thank you for your time.
Mm-hmm. Paul Kuntz. You're up, sir. Welcome.
Even, I actually have a handout if one for the clerk and one
for
each
just,
one of you.
Yeah, that's good.
Good evening. Sorry, I was standing out in the hallway and there's no speakers out there.
I know.
My name is Paul Kuntz and I'm here as the chair of the Alamance Chamber. The Alamance Chamber is made up of 800 businesses, small and large, throughout Alamance County. Our board of directors has adopted a resolution, and that's what I have handed up. This resolution is in support of educational funding for Alamance Burlington school system. We recognize that there are many factors that contribute to the health and success of the local economy, but the most critical factor for the economic health and success of Alamance County is a strong system for local education and workforce development. The Chamber regularly advocates on behalf of pro-business public policies that promote job creation and sustained economic growth. The Alamance Chamber has sponsored and facilitated the public process for the ABSS system vision plan and with the idea of building a best-in-class national model of education. After the vision plan came the strategic plan, and we all know that's the hard part. The strategic plan is being implemented in furtherance of this vision plan, and those of us, like myself, who participated in this vision planning process have regularly quarterly checkups that Superintendent Harrison takes us through, where we get to walk through the schools, talk to teachers, talk to students, and get data on the actual progress that is being made. The resolution by the board is that the Alamance Chamber supports county funding of the Alamance Burlington school system in a manner appropriate for fulfilling the public vision for a world-class local education system that supports the implementation of the strategic plan developed to meet the ideals set forth in the vision for public education in Alamance County. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Okay. While Paul's going back, Donna Parker.
Hi, thank you all for having me. It's good to see you this evening. I am here with a little different perspective. I'm with the Alamance Burlington County Association of Realtors, and also I work full-time for REMAX, so just here to kind of give everyone my view and probably a view of realtors in general about how our schools in Alamance County affect home buyers and where they choose to buy a home. And so essentially I got to see a little bit of the strategic plan in progress recently because I was afraid that was me because I'm a realtor, my phone's always on.
Need a little entertainment.
But we had a wonderful school tour provided for the association recently. It was the second of its kind, and we were truly amazed by, you know, what's actually happening with this visionary plan. And we were over at East Lawn and saw the new global program. I actually decided maybe I need to go back to school to learn some geography after that. It was pretty incredible. And then we were over in Mebane at Hallfields and Garrett, and the technology was fantastic. And then later they went on to Williams. So anyway, I saw the plan in action, and I realized that as realtors, we need to make our thoughts, you know, evident and how we feel about increasing the budget and having more money go into the school system, because as I'm sure, just like common sense, everyone would know that one of the first questions we're always asked is, okay, how's this school district? And we're always, you know, telling people to go on the sites and stuff because we're not supposed to show partiality. However, it's a huge reason for why people do or do not buy homes in a certain area. And as you know, great schools make people want to buy. And even the NAR has statistics showing that people will pay a premium price for a house that's in the school district that they desire. So it's certainly a consideration that people make all the time when they're going to buy a house. And we know that, you know, when we have great schools with success and stability, that in turn you get great communities. And I think that's one of the most special things that I have enjoyed since I moved to Alamance County 20 years ago is the sense of community. It's amazing. And I think tonight's show of support for the schools is a great indication of how much people value this community. So the one thing that no one else has really talked about that I did want to mention is that we're surrounded by three top six schools in the whole state. So, you know, we're competing with that. Then there's another in the top 20. And that's just to say that I ask for your support because I feel like schools have so much to do with the community. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Donna. Thank you. Ariel Hogarth.
Good evening, County Commissioners. Thank you for your time tonight. We appreciate the opportunity to speak to you. Good evening, members of the Alamance County community. My name is Ariel Hogarth, and I'm a 12-year social studies teacher at Eastern Alamance High School, and I also serve as the president of the Alamance Burlington Association of Educators. I'm here tonight to ask you to fully fund the budget request from the Alamance Burlington school system. And there are a few points I'd like to make. First, now is the time to get 100% on board with our vision and strategic plan. Dr. Harrison and our central office staff have put a budget request together that reflects both immediate and long-term goals. We've spent countless hours with many Alamance County citizens constructing a vision and a strategic plan. This budget request keeps us on target with this strategic plan. We are not even asking for the amount on the original draft. We are asking for a reasonable increase that will keep Alamance Burlington school system moving in a positive and progressive direction. Second, now is the time to show that you support education. At some time in your campaign, all of you stated that you supported education. Now is the time for you to keep your commitment and your campaign promises and fully fund our request. Commissioner Gailey, you made a very profound statement at the education forum hosted by Alamance for Ed at Elon University. You said that we've taken better care of our landfill than our schools. The landfill was a priority and it was funded as such. Now it's time for you all to make education a priority and fully fund it. Third, now is the time to stop pointing fingers and waiting for someone else to fund education. We are still recovering from years without facilities money from county commissioners in the years past. We are struggling with a per pupil expenditure that is $3,000 below the national average. We are trying to push forward under a General Assembly that has underfunded education, as well as degraded and disrespected amazing educators who work day in and day out for our students. The state has to stop all the blaming, the local blaming the state blaming the local, everyone blaming the federal. This pointing has to stop. Everyone from Graham to Raleigh to Washington, D.C. has to realize that all levels must fund and fully support education. The price we pay is the future of our county. The people of Alamance County elected you to lead us and secure the future of Alamance County. Now is the time for you to make a decision to fund the ABSS budget request and decide on the best means to do it. If you all continue to hold back or underfund or point fingers at the General Assembly or the central office staff or the principals or the teachers, the effect will be devastating. Maybe not today, maybe not next week, but every day and every year that goes by is a year of education in the life of a student that we cannot get back. Now is the time. Fully fund the schools our students deserve. Thank you.
Thank you, Erin. Freebird McKinney. Good evening.
How are you?
Good.
Hey, how are you doing?
Good, thank you.
So, good evening, County Commissioners and members of the ABSS community. My name is Freebird McKinney, and I've said this before and I'll say it again, I believe in the institution of Alamance Burlington Public School System. There's an old Greek proverb that reads that wise men and women plant trees of which they will never know the shade. And I believe that this community is planting trees. We all see it firsthand, and we experience it personally on a day-to-day basis. As husbands and wives and mothers and fathers and active citizens of our community, we thrive in the energy of our community. And as teachers, we live the pledge of our county and its leaders to our students. As cooperating teachers working with student teachers from Elon, we receive the benefits of a world-class university and its partnership to grow tomorrow's educators. As recent graduates of the Impact Alamance Teacher Leadership Academy, we can also speak to the actions carried out by our community and its members in support of Alamance Burlington Public School System. But all of these institutions know it relies on public education, and to keep this going, we need more. The Teacher Leadership Academy is a community partnership between the Alamance Burlington School System, Impact Alamance, the Alamance Chamber, Elon University, and Alamance Community College. And each of these partners dedicated themselves to exhibiting their commitment to this partnership and its teachers and to public education. From the Chamber of Commerce to Alamance Regional Medical Center and Glen Raven, GKN, and LabCorp, we listen and learn about the amazing opportunities our local businesses are providing for our future graduates through their investment and this and its people. As Mr. Williams shared with this past TLA cohort, when a corporation or community is looking to invest in Alamance County, the Chamber is often contacted first. And a story from Mr. Williams' presentation illustrates the essence of our purpose here tonight. He discussed how a corporation during a tour of Burlington requested the results of the last bond referendum. This question revealed that companies desire to invest where a commitment to invest in one's own community has been made. So quite simply, it's time for this investment in our school system's budget. We are familiar with the drive to invest in our future, each and every one of us. The farmer knows it and invests his or her time and sweat equity in the sowing of the seeds. The businessmen and women know this with every measuring of opportunity cost. And the teachers know it with yearly creation of lesson plans and the art of relationship building. But this needs to be now. ABSS and our community has invested in the strategic plan, and it is working. We see it in the Career Acceleration Program, the International Baccalaureate Program, the Municipal Program, the various CTEC and STEM research programs. But frankly, these will perish without the passing of this budget. We desperately need to approve the next step of our budget and the validation of the necessary execution of this vision. ABSS requires our investment. Alamance County needs your commitment. And we have planted the seeds for our trees. Now let's invest in this shade. Thank you.
Thank you. I see Kathy Cole standing at the door, so if you want to come on up, it'll be great.
Am I ready to go?
You're ready.
All right, I appreciate that. Thank you all so much. I wanted to thank you, Commissioner Sutton, for your invocation. I thought it was very thoughtful and particularly oriented towards the evening. And those thoughts have been in my head just a little bit about sort of the gifts of our elders to us and the gift of self-governance. So I wanted to recognize that. And I did write some things down specific to the request. So I wear several hats in this community, and I speak on behalf of my hat that I wear as a mother today, and not for any other cause or agency and organization. I'm the mother of a 6-year-old son named Carl, who's a kindergartner at E.M. Yoder Elementary School, and the mother of a 9-year-old daughter, Gretchen, at South Mebane Elementary School. Gretchen became a South Mebane fact master last Thursday, which means that she now knows all of her times tables inside and out, up and down, and about 1,000 flashcard drills later, I know my times tables too. And Carl, meanwhile, is thinking and speaking and writing in Spanish after only a year of that new Splash immersion program at Yoder. And by the way, he does that in English too. But he didn't learn that Spanish at home, and we are amazed and blessed by his teachers and administrators. They surround each of my children with love, care, and a rigorous academic program. I want to share a quick story of going to Gretchen's kindergarten orientation. This is my first baby going off to school. This is where the kids come to school and they color stuff and they learn how to open the milk containers that they have in the school cafeteria. And then the parents are all shuffled off to a room and we sign documents. And one after the other, I watched incredibly talented school professionals get up and talk to us about their philosophy, their curriculum, and their process. And they were wise, and they were funny, and they were warm, and they were so reassuring to me. But I was very scared that day for two specific reasons. First of all, I looked around at the room. It was half the size, and it looked much worse off than the library in my elementary school in Kentucky. Despite the bright posters and the cheery decor, you could tell that it was just really old. And one of the speakers that day, I think she was the PTA president at the time, mentioned that they did one fundraiser a year and they tried to buy cool stuff like iPads and other technology. They'd once tried to raise funds for getting some air conditioning in the gym. And they also did stuff like fund postage and academic ribbons, like the attendance ribbons. And I thought to myself, where the heck am I raising my children? In a place that can't budget or fund a building, an AC, an attendance ribbon, and postage? And then the worst thought came to me. Am I giving my children less of an education than was given to me? And that's the fundamental question for us. Are we giving our children less than our parents and our grandparents handed down to us? The answer to that has to be no. We must be able to give them better, at least as much as we were given. But right now, I believe that the costs of providing their amazing educational opportunities fall on the backs of their very generous teachers and administrators. Our children go to school every day in buildings that tell them they deserve less than the best, that they deserve just enough, that they deserve leaky roofs and drafty windows and a first grade classroom where you have to wear your coat inside on cold days. Our teachers work for salaries far lower than other school districts and receive paychecks that tell them that they deserve less than the best. I've heard the superintendent's budget request described as overreaching and extraordinary, but I believe that it is bold. We can't give our children the best unless we're willing to pay to invest boldly in their futures.
Kathy, I cut you off.
I believe that families raise children, but communities raise children too.
3 minutes.
I want to do my part, okay. And I'm asking you to do yours.
Okay.
To give our children the educational opportunities that are their birthright.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, Robert Belani.
Esteemed commissioners and concerned citizens, I'm Robert Villani, an ABSS teacher, a homeowner, and a supporter of the 2017-2018 school budget, lock, stock, and barrel. Strong schools anchor a community. When I arrived here, my vision was to defend public education as a right, free for every child, regardless of zip code or intellectual capacity. But for some commissioners, vision is a four-letter word. So I should say no more. For some here and at large believe that ABSS is profligate. It feasts on the seed corn of the county. Wild Bill Harrison himself consults with those sharp college boys out at Elon to construct phrases like develop a plan for monitoring and evaluating implementation and impact of specialized programs. Just to hoodwink good, honest folk. Still, ABSS held numerous town meetings and heard sharp criticism of its redistricting plan at its board meetings, even though all of our stakeholders approved of the ABSS vision. But I say no more visions, for then I'd have to detail what many believe is your vision. Among you and at large are those who believe that it is best to squeeze each tax dollar until that eagle grins. But the very thing that makes us rich by your account makes us poor. And it's not just me. Graham's mayor, J.R.E. Peterman, said to the Times News, I hate to say the county is killing us, but they're killing us. They're reevaluating everything too low to avoid hearing complaints. That vision lacks imagination. Let us be clear. A 6-cent tax increase would add less than $150 to a tax bill. Homeowners know $150 does not go that far. But if we spend that this year on painting, fencing, landscaping, you name it, none of this grows our wealth. Only a property tax increase can. As a homeowner, I want my home's value to increase. All of us understand that plain-spoken public debate allows everyone to focus on long-term solutions and not short-term differences. We must build for our future. We must invest in our human capital, our students. They mirror our growing community and its complexity, and they all have pre-existing conditions. Brutalized as they are by broken homes, even in the best neighborhoods, poverty, and a popular culture that offers addiction by design. Education, like aspirin, is time-released. It takes time. So students cannot always jump through the hoops of mandated accountability, but in the end, education increases our capacity to be human. It only lifts us up, economically and spiritually. Schools anchor our community. Every potential county resident asks first about our schools. Are they properly funded? Support this budget with your vote, for the only thing that can make us prosper is investing in our collective future. And thank you for your time spent on this issue.
Thank you. All right. Now, we do have a few minutes left in our allotted time span. Is there a Michael DeVern?
Yeah.
Davern? Davern?
My name is Michael Davern. I'm a senior at Western Alamance High School, and as such, I've just completed a very rigorous application process for colleges, and we are not prepared for colleges. The kind of standards that are set for us are much higher than what Alamance County is offering for us. I know that I've taken a lot of the most challenging curriculum available to me, and I'm barely meeting the requirements for things that colleges are looking for. Nobody at my school got accepted into Duke University. My friend Andon is going to Yale, and that's only because 4 years ago, he made a decision to go to NCSSM so that he could better himself. So I've kind of talked about the academics, but the school buildings themselves also are lacking. In the middle school, several times a year, they'd have an announcement that said, don't drink the water today, because it was not safe to drink. How are we supposed to focus on academics whenever we're worried about if we can drink the water? In the band room, there's a closet that we're not allowed to use anymore because of asbestos. When it rains, I have to take an alternate class or an alternate route to my classes so I don't ruin my shoes because of flooding issues. I urge you guys to invest in education. And rather than simply meeting the requirements of a perfunctory education, to boost it, to invest so that we can have something greater. Because if you're just meeting the requirement for education, we're not going to get anywhere. Me and my classmates, we are the taxpayers of tomorrow, and after our 4 years, or however long we spend in college, or if we don't go to college, we have the decision. Stay in Alamance County or leave. Any of us who want to have families and children will not be staying in Alamance County if we value education. There are many neighboring counties, Guilford County, for example. They spend $2,600 per student. In Alamance County, we spend $1,700. There's a direct correlation between that and test scores. The ABSS or composite ACT mean is 17.4. Guilford County is 18. The percentage of students who meet all the benchmarks plus writing in Alamance County is 7.3%. In Guilford County, it's 10.3%. With this data, we can see that there's a direct correlation between increased spending on students and their performance. That's all I have.
Very good. Thank you so much. Thank you. Good job. Sean Quinn.
Good evening.
Good evening.
How you doing?
I just wanted to take a moment and reiterate what most of the speakers have said. But first, I want to thank you, because I don't know how I would do your job. I'm a civics teacher at Western High School. I'm also a county resident. And I think the sacrifice you make as elected officials is amazing, because you have to sit down and try to prioritize every one of these things that we're up here talking about. And I guess the best way I can put this, without having to kind of rehash everything that was said, is that we in this community value education as teachers. We spend every day going to work, putting our time forward, and trying to be the best teachers we can be. I don't know a single teacher who goes to work and says, I'm just going to collect a paycheck. I think we spend our time, we work hard for you. And I came with prepared remarks to try to explain all those things that would be, and I can't top what some of these other people have said, so there's no point in rehashing and taking time away from others. But I guess I put it this way. For the first time in my teaching career, I've pursued other options. I've sat down and looked at graduate programs or things that I could do that may be better for my family to allow me to raise my children at the level that other counties allow their teachers to. And I don't know what to do anymore, because I feel like if we fully fund our schools and we fully fund the budget that's being requested, we will have teachers stay in the profession, we will have teachers stay in this community, and every dime that you put forth into a budget will come back to you tenfold. I beg of you to do so. I do not envy your position, but I hope that you will highly consider Dr. Harrison's budget, his vision, and allowing us as teachers to continue to do the job that we love to do every single day. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Neil Schledorn. Probably butchered that. But. Hey, how are you?
How you doing?
Good evening. Thank you. It's a pleasure to speak with you today. My name is Neil Schledorn. I'm currently my 13th year at Williams High School. Alamance County is the only place I've ever taught, and in all honesty, it's the only place I ever plan to teach. I don't plan on moving anytime soon. I want to look at things a little bit different today. There's been recent discussion about how the school system will measure the success of the strategic plan, and I'd like to show, well, I'd like to talk about some of the ways that it has already been successful. So Commissioners Boswell and Gailey, I had the pleasure of meeting you at Southern Middle School. You were there for my wife's Southern Future Leadership Day. 30 professionals interviewed more than 200 sixth graders. They said it was the first time many of them had ever spoken with a real adult. They were left with skills, they were left with confidence that it's going to follow them through the rest of their lives. An empowered staff made that possible, and initiative and building level leadership made that possible. Now, in the 2015-2016 school year, only 4 of our schools did not meet or exceed extended growth. Teachers are reflecting on their craft, they're honing what needs to be honed, and we have the growth to prove it. In the most recent National School Boards Association conference, ABSS had 3 presentations. One of those presentations was on Impact Alamance and their Teacher Leadership Academy, which I was just a member of. We are a national model. ABSS is getting so good at training teacher leaders that districts from around the country are trying to copy us. The Career Accelerator program is giving our high school students access to high-paying jobs immediately after graduation. Participating companies are agreeing to pay for their post-secondary education. We're nearing the end of the IB rollout. We just finished student interviews, and we're working on scheduling now. We start a summer's honors institute that's going to serve more than 30 students at Elon. These are just a few of the special programs that were called for in the strategic plan. There are dozens of other accomplishments that previous members have already said, but I encourage you guys to visit our schools and learn about them firsthand. And again, the reason we're successful and the reason we're doing this is because we have a plan. Successful organizations and successful businesses and successful institutions all have a plan. They all look to the future. And again, I respect how hard it is to craft a county budget. I could not do it myself, and I will readily admit to that. But we have a plan. The money is not for nothing. The money is not some nebulous concept. It all goes to a specific place with specific goals and specific outcomes. So thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Okay. Well, we're approaching our hour mark. I've got to ask, is there anyone here that would like to comment on the budget other than for these schools? I know we had one gentleman about fire tax. Let me see. David Hensley. Mr. Gant, you want to come on and speak while we're waiting on Mr. Hensley? Good evening, sir.
How you doing?
Good evening. Alan Gant, CEO at Glen Raven. Appreciate what you all do. It's a tough job. Been some mighty incredible things said tonight. There's one benefit mentioned in the Constitution of North Carolina. It's education. Just one. When I read the first page of your vision in your budget, in the middle of the page, it says world-class education. If we are serious about world-class education, then we need to make it the number one priority for this community. There are lots of companies putting their money where their mouth is. Glen Raven, in the last 10 or 12 years, I would imagine have put over $500 million in employment into this community. We're talking about a lot of money. Today, we're involved in the building project for another 30 that we hope to be in by December. We have 22 job openings today. They've been open for 9 months. We can't fill them because we can't find the people we need. If you want economic development, if you want to move this county forward, then have the courage to invest in education. I think that we are in the top 5 or 6 taxpayers in this community. As a matter of fact, I looked up what each one of you all pay taxes on. And I know what I pay taxes on. And I would gladly take an increase in taxes if that's what it takes to make us world class, and you're committed to world class. It's just that simple. Without education, we have poverty. Without education, we have crime. If you educate people to understand what the consequences are of all of those things out there, they can make better decisions. It's up to you to make those decisions. It's not an easy job. That's what you get paid the big bucks for, is to make those tough decisions. It's what I have to do in my job. We reinvent ourselves every single year. Bill, I think you and I were in the first class that went to Turntide.
That's right, we were.
You and I walked in the door coming from Broad Street in January.
That's right.
Last year, the connector between those two buildings was condemned. How embarrassing for us to have a building that we have children in that was condemned because it was falling apart.
Yes.
All I can say is, Bill, you and I had a better chance. And it's time for you to dig deep and support this educational budget 100%. Don't cut it a penny. We need every dime. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Okay. David?
Thank you. I do want to say I am thankful tonight that I am not a county commissioner.
True. I was hoping you might want to trade.
You ran a couple years ago. When? How long was that?
Don't go there. It was at the wrong time. But I'm thankful also that you take time to listen to our proposals and appreciate the three guys here from the AO. They've got the chief, Lipscomb, Chuck Gantos, you're the chairman of the board. And there's
Camille Thomas.
Camille, been known right. I can't think of the name. Justin. I appreciate it. And I want them to know I am not against the fire department. I love these guys. I appreciate what they do. I really do. I'm against an increase in the tax. And I've had to have the fire department on my property three times to fight fires because of my neighbors. It wasn't mine. You know, it just got over on my property. But anyhow, I won't have time to finish this tonight, but I want to ask you, how many board members do we have? 12. Used to be run by 5. I'm not going there. Former chief's mother was the treasurer. I'm sorry, but that is a conflict of interest. The chief now, when he came on, his father was the chairman of the board. Conflict of interest. His father is on the board still. Not even a resident of the fire district or the county. I do not like somebody coming from another county to tell me how much tax I ought to pay for my district. I don't like that. I don't dislike the person. I like Eddie. I consider him to be my friend. I don't know his daddy that good. I got some of my questions answered. I've attended these meetings, and Amy and Eddie, I appreciate y'all coming to the last meeting and to see, but I have been going to these meetings, and there have been times over the last probably 25 years that I would be the only person at the annual meeting who was not a member of the fire department. I have two brothers who served probably 40 years or better on that department. I never did. But I talked to a guy today when he saw Mr. Lipscomb on television. Very, you look pretty good on TV. Yeah. But he called me. He is a paid fireman in another district, but he lives now within a half a mile of the AO Fire Department. And he called me and he said, they don't need more money. He said, what they need is better management. They proposed an increase in the fire tax back in 2014, I believe, to man the new substation. And they're gonna ask again to get that. What did they do with the money? $174,000 in the bank. What are they gonna do with that money? And again, I'm thankful for these firemen. Now, I'm glad that if I go to bed at night and I have to have them, I can call them. I can run down there as quick as I can call them and get them, and they'll be there. Eddie knows that. He's come to my house. I was burning a brush pile. He came in and said, David, is that you? Yeah. Is it under control? Yeah, I've got my hose pipe out here. I got everything under control. I appreciate that. I really do. But I don't appreciate paying more taxes when I don't think it's necessary. Thank you.
Very good. Thank you, David. All right. Is there anyone else that just got to speak? We got about 6 minutes left. Barrett, would you like to speak?
Hello.
How you doing?
All right. Thanks for hearing my comment. I appreciate it. I'm Barrett Brown. I'm the president of the Alamance branch of the NAACP. And I came prepared to talk about education, but I think the points have been fairly well made. I think I'm coming because the NAACP advocates for social justice and civil rights to ensure that all citizens participate in full citizenship. And two pillars of that support that full citizenship in a democratic republic are education and access to the ballot. So I would ask that you fully fund the board of the school board's budget so that we can make an investment in our children so that they can become informed and participatory members of citizenry, and that you fund the Board of Election budget so that they have the means in which to provide access to the ballot for citizens, locations, extended times, and equipment. What we hear when we go to advocate is that we just don't have the money. The county commissioners didn't give us the money to keep to have Sunday voting or to have an additional polling place. So we'd ask that you extend your attention. Well, you fully fund the Board of Elections and the school board. It's a real opportunity to be bold and to be courageous. I mean, I know that raising taxes is not the most popular thing, but in this instance, it's so necessary to our democracy that we have educated and students and citizens and access to the ballot that you think to yourself in this time, do we live up to the North Carolina toast where we the weak can go strong and the strong can go great? And I think that those two particular components are necessary for that. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, sir. Peter. Yeah.
Thank you all very much, and I'll be very brief, Commissioner. So I've got remarks. I'll email them to
cut
you.
Cut them down.
I just want to make 2 points. My colleague, Dean Ann Bullock, and I are here as representatives of Elon University, speaking on behalf of fully supporting the budget. The university believes very strongly in the power of education and the power of public education in this county. And so on behalf of President Lambert and all my colleagues, we support this. Secondly, I want to speak as a parent. Sean Quinn, who was up here a few minutes ago, is my daughter's favorite teacher at Western. My daughter just finished her first year at Davidson College. She's doing great, thanks to Mr. Quinn. Just on my daughter's behalf, it's appalling to have her favorite teacher say he's thinking about other careers because the schools aren't funded. Do what you can, please.
Very good. Thank you. Yes, sir. State your name.
Okay, my name is Derek Tang. I live on 2703 May Drive in Burlington. Commissioners, I would like to name you all, but I know I'm working on a short time here. I'm going to cut straight to the chase.
That's good.
I've been struggling all week since being asked by my children's principal if I would come and speak this evening. And I actually turned to Facebook to crowdsource. And I posted a question this morning, and I asked, what do you value in public education beyond test scores and assessment data? These are some of the answers I received. Students get to learn to work in peer groups. Students get to develop positive responsibility and habits. Teachers get to spark a love of learning in the thousands of students they get to encounter. Students are encouraged to learn social skills and emotional intelligence. We have teachers who are creative rather than simply teaching to the curriculum or teaching to the test. We have programs that offer holistic learning beyond the 3 R's, like the arts and STEM. We have access to specialized services for families and students in need in our county. Students develop fine motor skills. These are all intangibles. By nature, intangibles can't be measured. And as Freebird mentioned just a little while ago, we won't know the benefit of this until years down the road. I used to work in ministry. You don't see the fruits of ministry until years down the road. This is difficult to reconcile in a result-oriented society where we want to see A's and high B's, and we want to see 90s and 100s, but it's the reality that intangibles are all around us. I'm a Panthers fan. How do I measure the value of Luke Kuechly's leadership to the team? You can't value that. You can't place a numerical value on that, even though the million-dollar contract says so. I'm a Johnny Cash fan. How do I measure his appeal to the downtrodden in society, the fans who loved him, that were looked down upon by their peers? More to the point, throughout history, we have held captains of industry, politicians, economists, all in high esteem for their ability to project intangibles. Just to clarify, I agree, as Commissioner Gailey, we do need accountability. We do need to measure somehow. Nobody is suggesting to throw money at the problem like a Band-Aid on a hemorrhage, but ABSS is not a hemorrhage. Our schools, our children, our teachers, they're an investment. You've heard that word several times this evening. They are an investment for the future. Not for me and my four kids, not for my wife, but for the entire county, for our state, for our country even. An investment involves a leap of faith that cannot necessarily be measured. To keep moving forward together, we need to improve teacher morale and compensation. We need to equip and empower students through tech and extracurriculars. We need to provide safe and updated environments. At some point, we need to be on the right side of history on this. The stakes are way too high. Years from now, I'm going to have to answer my children. And not just to the commissioners right now, but to everybody, I'm going to ask, how are you going to answer to yours? Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. And we got someone, okay, Doc Yarmer. And I'll catch you in just 1 second.
Good evening, thank you. And I am going to be extremely brief. You know, years ago, the clothing industry had a tag in its clothes that said one size fit all. Well, you know, my sister wears a size 5. Now, do you think I could wear her clothes? I'm not saying what size I am, but I bet you I cannot wear that size 5. So they changed it, and then they put in there one size fits most. Well, that doesn't work either. So now if you look in the tag of the clothes, it says one size. Well, let me tell you what the school system has done. The school system has done an assessment through its strategic planning. They realize that one size doesn't fit all. They realize that one size does not fit most. But they do realize that we need more than one size. So what they have done is they're looking at our students. They're talking about all of the programs that they'd like to implement. Some have been mentioned tonight, such as STEM, such as the leader in me, such as emerging globally, fire technology, all of these programs, because some of these programs, all of these programs will fit some of our students, or most of our, that will be an opportunity for our students. Yes, these programs need funds. It needs the teachers to operate them, and it needs conducive a classroom environment to hold these programs. At the last budget meeting, I think I heard Commissioner Sutton say, you know, when we presented this budget, he said, I've heard that for about 20 years. Well, you know what? That's actually unfortunate, because that just simply means we've been underfunding the school system for the last 20 years. So we don't want you to have to underfund the school system for another 20 years. What we'd like for you to do is fund this budget, hold the school systems accountable, and watch Alamance County grow. And to borrow from the NAACP, the only way we can do that is forward together, because we cannot afford to take one step back.
Doug Hargrove.
Yes.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening. My name is Doug Hargrove, and my roots are in Alamance County. I was raised elsewhere, but I've chosen to return to raise my own family here, so in many ways, I bring an outsider's perspective. Alamance County is home to a proud people, people with solid core values, a strong work ethic, neighbors you can rely on, all the qualities that we pass along to the next generation. A few decades ago, ours was an economy based on agriculture and manufacturing, and those qualities alone could bring success. But the world has changed. Success now means being trained for the work available in today's world, like Mr. Gant pointed out. Our students succeed when provided a K-12 experience that prepares them to pursue a higher degree or to enter the workforce. The basis for all success lies in knowledge and education. The proposed 2017-2018 budget supports a vision for the ABSS schools, one that ensures our students have access to quality educational opportunities with highly skilled staff and modern facilities. These funds will improve our students' future opportunities as well as improve our community's appeal. We're a proud people. We must take pride in our school system as well. Our schools are training the future leaders of Alamance County. Future doctors and teachers are walking our hallways. Future farmers, engineers, and lawyers are sitting in our classrooms. If we're not on the side of funding an educational system that's competitive with neighboring counties, with ensuring that students have access to the most qualified teachers and facilities equipped to challenge and support them, if we don't support this most basic right of our children of Alamance County, then what is our vision? How do we see ABSS improving as we move forward? Do we want to be short-sighted or visionary? In the end, it really comes down to one of two things. Either we're growing and evolving, or we're dying. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Okay, we've actually gone over a few minutes, but I'm going to ask, is there anyone that has anything that's not in support of the school? I think we need, if there's any taxpayers got something they want to bring up. I know Tony Cox is on our list, and I'm not sure what he's talking about because he didn't put it down. Tony, are you here, sir?
Yeah, he left.
Tony is not here. Okay. All right. Hearing no more, then we will close our public hearing and ask for commissioner comments.
Wasn't a public hearing.
Well, I know it wasn't. Really. Yeah, it seemed like it.
I'll just say thank you to everybody for coming out tonight. It's really awesome to see such to see people speaking out about something that's so important to them and to their community, and you've definitely given me a lot to think about. I like to make little notes about what people are saying, so for one, I can and remember, and I think I've got 4 pages of notes here, so but it was just a lot to think about, and I really appreciate you being here. And if anybody wasn't able to speak tonight who would like to, would really encourage you to come out June 5th at 7 o'clock. We'll be at the historic courthouse. And if anybody, you know, seeing this between here and there, you know, seeing the either on the cable TV or on the commissioner's portal, would love to hear from everybody about what they think about the whole county budget. So thank you so much for being here.
I'd like to say a few things. Depending on what I heard tonight, I was going to say a lot more, but I don't think I need to, because what was said was so eloquently said and very complete. And I just appreciate everybody showing their support for good reasons to support public education. I was going to talk about the importance of visioning and planning, since I did a lot of that in my career. And I was disappointed to read in one of our newspapers an editorial that really belittled planning and visioning. But I would just say that I think Mr. Gant hit it on the head that Glen Raven wouldn't be where it is today without having a vision and a plan. And I dare say neither would LabCorp or Elon University or Alamance Regional Medical Center and Cone Health. And it's just, planning is one thing, but it's the execution of that plan that really makes the difference. And to execute the plan that we have before us, that ABSS, the Board of Education, has adopted, is going to require resources, investment, and commitment from all of us. There's a lot said tonight about some great things going on in ABSS, and I go to just about every school board meeting and work session, and I'm privy to a lot of accolades being presented to our students and to our teachers. And I've toured around the schools, being a member of the original Vision Plan Committee. I enjoy those quarterly updates. We have really good teachers, and we don't want to lose them. And I'll bet you that everybody in this room knows of some teachers that have used to work in ABSS that don't no longer work here, and I know some that are really good. And some of the ones that we heard tonight, we don't want to lose them. The specialized programs that are being funded by this budget, just tremendous things going on. I'm not going to mention them, but you know, the A+, the SPLASH, all these things that were recognized tonight. And there's been a lot of progress made on meeting goals. The teacher working condition survey has shown improvement. Our teacher turnover rate is below the state average for the first time that anybody can remember. It was already mentioned about the student growth results that just about all of our schools have met or exceeded. And look at what we have. We have leadership in place, wonderful Board of Education, very committed. They don't always agree. That's good. There's discourse is good. But we have more accountability than I can remember in this community. And now we even have the new metrics on the website that we can use. And thank you, Amy, for helping with that initiative. This is a time of tremendous community support with Alamance Achieves, aligning the community resources around educating our kids, because it really takes more than just the schools themselves. Kids are only in school for so much. And if a child doesn't enter our school system kindergarten ready, their chances of success isn't going to be very high. So this needs to be a community effort, but part of that community effort is providing the funding necessary for this to be successful. And what everything we've talked about tonight aligns with strategic plans of other places in the community, like the Chamber of Commerce that we heard about, one of our own pillars, strategic pillars, the City of Graham, and Councilman Griffin McClure had a wonderful editorial in the paper yesterday. So this budget request is targeted on strategies and achieving goals, and I don't know what our manager is going to be is going to submit to us this evening for us to chew on, but this isn't a time to hold back, and as we seem to have done for years, and I agree, we need to be leaders. That's why I feel like I got elected, because in my campaign, I ran on a platform in 2014, mostly on education, but also on some other things like integrity and planning, and in fiscal responsibility, which means investing wisely, investing on things with our taxpayer dollars that's going to generate a return. And I think education will probably be the investment that will generate the most returns of anything that we could possibly do. And I didn't promise to keep our tax rate as low as possible. What I said that I would promise to keep our tax rate reasonable and comparable to similar counties. Serving on the Vision Plan Committee was the reason I decided to run for office, because you know, this is a long process. We met 3 hours at a time every 3 weeks for 9 months, and during those meetings we had a lot of discussion, and it came up over and over again about the lack of funding from our county. And I thought, you know, I'm going to be retiring, and maybe I can help do something about that. And so that's why I really decided to run for county commissioner. So I don't know exactly what it's going to cost to fully fund. I've got some ideas, but I think whatever it is, we can afford it. I think that we can hardly afford not to fully fund it. When you look at the budget and what's being requested, there's about six or seven items there. One of it is capital, and it's $750,000. And after touring some of our schools, Williams a week or two ago, and last week Eastern Alamance, and before that Southern, and I've been into a lot of schools, and I see a lot of crumbling asphalt and cracked sidewalks and roofs that have rust and mold. I mean, if I were a company looking to come to Alamance County, and I'm sending out my scouts to look at what our schools look like, I don't think I'd be very inspired, and that's not what we want. You know, we we're at 58 cents right now. 58 cents tax rate for $100 evaluation is the 28th lowest property tax rate in this state. The median tax rate is 67.7 cents. We're way below the median. In fact, if you look at all the counties that touch Alamance County, there's about six of them, I think. The next lowest besides us is Chatham County, and they're at 63.38 cents. So we're over 5 cents lower than the next lowest county. Then it goes up from there, Randolph, 65.2, Caswell, 67.9, Rockingham, 69.6. Guilford, which is one of the counties we really compete for, I heard at Williams High School, Dr. Harrison say that of all the teachers that we lose half of them to Guilford and Orange counties, I believe you said. So Guilford's tax rate is 75.5 cents. Orange is 87.8 cents. And I know a lot of personal teachers that have gone to Durham County. Durham's at 74 cents. So even if we just went to 62 cents, that's 4 cents more than we have now. If I do the math right, and Brian, Susan, help me if I do this right. So 4 cents on a $150,000 home is $60 a year, $5 a month. Is that what it amounts to?
Let me compute that real quick.
Can't be too far off. So if that's the kind of money, that we're talking about, and I'm not sure that it is because we have to hear our budget presentation, I'm for it. I'll vote for the whole thing. Thank you.
Tim?
Forgive me, Bob. You and I have already had this conversation. You don't set tax rates based on how they look. You set tax rates on based on what you feel like you need to set it to run an efficient government. This may be a decision that is not efficient, but we make a decision on what the tax rate must be to have government services and so forth.
I agree 100%.
And it may cost more to have government services in those other counties, and I would contend that that's the case. Guilford County's tax rate is 50% higher than ours, and I wouldn't trade with them for what they're getting for that 50 cents, and I don't think it's totally can be analyzed on school results. You know, there's been something said about our legacy. I'm not worried about my legacy. Good or bad, I'll tell you what I think. I do my research. I'm open. I don't hide figures. I don't think I twist figures. I put it all out there for the public to see. The gentleman from Cummings, I've talked to him before about the arts scenario at Cummings, but he and I had a good conversation. The tone tonight was, I don't think he was real pleased with me, but he made the reference that some of us want to squeeze the eagle until it dies.
Smiles.
Or smiles, or what was the phrase?
I think he said smiles.
Or whatever. But if we don't squeeze it in this country, tonight's going to be small potatoes compared to what we are going to have to address fiscally in this nation. Because if this nation loses fiscally, we all lose down at the local level. And I think we're just part of that puzzle. Small piece of that pie. My father, none of y'all knew him. I don't think. I was born here, but I lived in North Carolina, Virginia, Alabama, South Carolina. He ran some of the biggest plants that Burlington Industries had in those states. And he didn't have a college education. He always told me he went to the school of hard knocks. And I asked him one time, I said, well, how did you work your way up to management at May Hosiery here in Burlington? That's where it started. He said, well, he tried to be different. He said all the men wore basically the tank top t-shirts. He wore a dress shirt. He said, I tried to stand out. And he worked his way up to plant management. I think he could have been area supervisor, but he said he wanted to be home at 5 o'clock with his family every day. And Lord, did we appreciate that. My mother and my big brother. But Dad told me one time, he said, you know, Burlington would send him a directive to get something done out on the floor. And Alan, again, I'm sure is familiar with some of these terms. They used to have these long knitting machines with the wood runners going in between each machine. I ran on those wood runners when I was a kid and slid on my socks as far as I could slide when I was a kid. And he told me that Burlington would send down a directive that they had to do something out on that floor that the workers said they couldn't do. And he said he listened to them. He said he'd go in, take off his shirt, take off his tie, put on a work shirt, and he'd go out on the floor and he'd say, look, I'm either going to show you we can do it, or I'll tell them we can't do it. And he said normally they could do it. I'm not so sure that in this country, all the way down to the state, local level, that we've taken off our tie, that we've taken off our shirt, put on our work shirt, and prove that we can do it out in the ranks. That's all I'm trying to do. I look at the stats that I look at. I don't try to flavor anything. Some people don't believe that. That's fine. But my legacy, I'm not worried about being considered the most conservative commissioner in this county, or whether I'm not, whether somebody else is. I'm not worried about how many times I say no versus yes. I'm proud of the research that I've done as a commissioner. I'm proud of the money I've saved this county as a commissioner. And $500,000 of that a year came from the school system, where you had the largest administrator per 1,000 students, roughly, in the state. And we had state auditor look at that after we voted down an auditor that was going to spend $49,000 or a consultant to basically tell the school system what they wanted to hear. State auditor said you got 9 administrators too many, $500,000 in savings, and the school system took that $500,000 and put it into assistant principals to go out to the other schools. So, you know, there's all kind of good things that can come from analysis, and sometimes the votes that are no, or the votes that are yes. I don't know how I'll vote on any of this yet, but I'm not worried about a legacy. I can assure you I'm not worried about a legacy. Thank you.
Bill, any comments?
No comments.
Well, in closing out this session, I do want to thank everyone that came tonight. I know several folks couldn't get in. I noticed actually one of the school board people, Brian Feely, and we have Allison Gant and Stephen Van Pelt was here, and Patsy was here. And I don't know, are there any others in the back?
I think Tony Rose is here.
Tony Rose, okay. Well, thank y'all for showing up tonight. And thanks for what you do for our children. I've got 2 grandkids, and I appreciate it every day. And Bob and I went to a County Commissioner Day in Raleigh last week, and the big topic in Raleigh is the commissioners recognize we need to go to our legislators. We need to work with them to get money too. There's an $8.1 billion proposal out there for school construction coming from legislators. I hope they pass it. I would like for us as a community to encourage that too. But one comment I heard, and that was from a political strategist that talked to us, said what our future looks like tomorrow will depend on what we invest in today. And I firmly believe that, and I ran on that as a commissioner this last 2 times, and I've not changed my thought on that, and I don't know where we're going to be on this thing, but I will support the school to the best of my ability. I'm not going to promise everything, but that's just the way life is. I wish I could promise the taxpayers weren't going to raise taxes too, but it may be inevitable. So thanks everyone for coming out. Anyone that wants to come to our June 5th meeting, you're free to come back and speak again, because that will actually be our public hearing. So thank you very much. And any of you have to leave, we will take a quick recess. All right, consent agenda. Is there anything on there that anyone needs to pull to talk about?
I move approval of the consent agenda.
Okay, thank you, Bob.
Second.
Thank you, Amy. All in favor?
Aye.
All right. Next, we're going to have a proclamation for Motorcycle Awareness Week. Let me make sure I get the right. Let's come down and do both of these at the same time. Here you go, sir. This is a proclamation for motorcycle safety, and being a motorcycle rider myself, I appreciate y'all watching out for us. We have a day here with the CERN bikers, and I'm not going to read all of it, but it's very important that this month that we pay attention on the roads, and I'll let you speak a little bit to that, Mr. And watch out, because motorcycles are not seen very well, and I can promise you, I know that from experience too. So, anyhow, as drivers, we just need to pay attention and look out for our fellow motorcyclists out there. Here you go, Dave. Thank you for coming.
The only thing that I'd like to say is that the Alamance County CBA, Concerned Bikers Association, we are a legislative as well as an educational and safety-minded organization. We go into the schools. We teach the driver the motorcycle awareness portion of the driver's ed curriculum. The kids are required to get an hour a class of motorcycle awareness. We do this purely volunteer of our own free time. We even fund our own materials that we need for classes. I heard a lot of good things tonight about getting money in the education system. I agree with most every one of them, because the smarter the kids are, the better they learn, the more attentive they are. And attentive drivers keep me and my friends alive.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dave. All right, if I can get Ray to come down, May 21st through the 27th is National Emergency Medical Services Week. And I'll let you just kind of give us a brief highlight of what this is all about, sir.
All right, so it's just a week set aside every year to commemorate the men and women that serve their communities in emergency medical services, and just kind of remember the sacrifices that they make and the difference that they make in the lives of all of our citizens day in and day out. And so it's just a resolution to honor them on that.
Yep. Thanks to all the, I know some of them may be in the back, some of our firemen and so forth. Thank y'all for what you do.
All right. Well, General Prince.
All right, now we're down to the part where we all came for. Mr. Brian Haygood, I guess you or Susan or y'all tag teaming or?
Susan's going to pass out copies of the
presentation this evening.
She's going to pass out copies of my presentation to you this evening, as well as the copies of the manager's recommended budget, the hard copy. To tell everybody that's here this evening, this information will be posted on the county's website shortly after the meeting, both my presentation and the recommended budget. Mr. Chairman and Commissioners, good evening. It's a privilege to be able to come before you this evening and present my recommended budget for the 2017-18 year. I'm going to be passing a lot of information to you. I put a lot of data in this presentation. I'm going to go over with you. If you have any questions at any time during it, I'll certainly try to answer them, and Susan will sure try to help also. And before I get into this presentation, I want to take just a moment and thank Susan Roberts and Andrea Rollins and Sherry Hook for all the help that they provided with putting this together. It's been a lot of work, put together crunching numbers, looking at different scenarios. Also like to thank all the department heads and the heads of all outside agencies, including ACC and ABSS, for all their help and the input that they provided us. So with no further ado, we'll get right into it and go through this information. As we did in the budget retreat, I'd like to start off with information about our strategic plan. Our plan is called Vision Alamance, and we have tried, this is the first year that we've really tried to incorporate, we talk with our department heads, we look at how we're spending our money, our different pillars, You can see them all there, and it should be comforting to know that we have referenced this plan as we put together this budget that I'm recommending to you this evening. So the recommended budget, the total budget that I'm recommending that the county commissioners consider is $169,001,175. The general fund budget that I'm recommending is $147,144,499. When you see the various other funds. I'm not going to go into much about the other funds. I think most of the spending we're probably concerned about is general fund spending, so I'll spend a lot of time talking about that tonight. If you have any questions about the other funds, we'll be happy to answer those as they come up. A little bit of information about the budget. As you remember back at the retreat, the total general fund requests at that time were over $155 million. And that did not include health care cost increases for employees or any kind of pay raise for employees or some of our capital projects. So that was a significant amount of money requested. Again, as I mentioned, the general fund budget I'm recommending to you is over $147 million. So you can see that there have been reductions made to the original request. So to give you an idea of how we're proposing to spend this general fund money, county government is proposed to spend $98 million. You can see how it breaks down. County services is the county government departments and our court partners at a little over $88 million. And I will go through this information in a little bit more detail. This is just kind of a summary. Education, the total spending for education I propose is $44,845,109. And for our outside agencies, $4,271,738. And I am proposing and recommending to you that we maintain our current property tax rate of 58 cents. As we are required by the state, we are required to disclose to you what revenue neutral is. We use a document prepared by the state to come up with a revenue neutral tax rate. The assessed value after all of our appeals came in at $13.6 billion. You can see that's the top number. We averaged growth over the past 8 years of 1.45% in base value. Our revenue neutral tax rate is 57.44 cents, so it's 0.5744 is revenue neutral. Our collection rate that we are proposing to use for 17-18 is 98.64%. We are much higher on motor vehicles. Now the state is taking that over at almost 100%. The revenue that we estimate to come in from property taxes is $77,391,028. That is at the revenue neutral rate. And 1 cent in this budget equals $1.3 million. So 1 cent on the property tax rate will generate the $1.3 million figure that you see. Little information, obviously this was a revaluation year. Our tax base in 2016 was $13.3 billion. After the reval was completed, our tax base for 2017 will be $13.6 billion. That's a change of $323 million, over $323 million to the good. That's a good sign for us. We've had growth in residential and industrial building, and that's very good news. That's a 2.43% change from 2017. So I showed you this slide at the budget retreat, but we've updated it after we were really waiting on our appeals to come in, so we've been able to make this a little bit more accurate. You can see that over the 8 years since our revaluation in 2009, we have gained over $1 billion in property tax base value, which is about a 9.1% rate of growth since 2009. So our revenue sources for this budget, I'm recommending we stay at a 58 cent property tax rate. Combine that with our 98.64% collection rate, which we have to use that rate. That's the rate that we're required to use. We are going to be seeing, if we maintain this property tax rate, a $4.7 million increase in the amount of property tax that we will collect as opposed to 16-17. Then for sales tax revenue, we're projecting a $1.9 million increase that we have worked into this budget. So we're looking at that. We feel that's a conservative estimate based on how sales tax in Alamance County has trended over the past couple of years. This budget will also use fund balance. We are appropriating $6.3 million in fund balance to balance our budget, and we have $530,000 in designated funds that we are proposing to use.
Those funds will be used for economic development infrastructure at some of our payments we owe for the North Carolina Commerce Park. Put back money for revaluation, because that will be around again before we know it. And it also, the designated money covers our LME retirees' health. And I'll go over a little bit more about fund balance. I'll show you a slide about our history of fund balance use and how this stacks up with previous years. We do have 8 departments with fee changes. I'm not going to go through what every one of those fee changes are. You can look in the budget book on pages 5 and 6 and read about those. I would encourage you to do so. That way you're familiar with them. I just didn't plan to go through all those fee changes. I will say that the EMS fee changes, I want to touch on those again. I talked about those at the retreat. This is where we're going to the Medicaid allowable. This is how we are, you're going to see a request in here to do some significant funding for EMS. This is how we're proposing to cover most of those costs, is by going to what market is for our ambulance service. I want to mention that specifically. But all of these departments' fee increases are pulled out specifically. You can see them very easily, pages 5 and 6 of the budget book. So a little bit of information about fund balance. According to our audit that was completed for fiscal year 15-16, our unassigned fund balance is a little over $31 million. That comes to 22.7% of our expenditures. You know, the board has set a goal for this to be 25%. So you can see in the graph below how we have used fund balance over the past several years. We're budgeting this year, we're planning to budget $6.3 million. You can see this fiscal year, 16-17, we budgeted 5.7 to balance. We believe we will turn back in, return to fund balance. We will not spend that $5.7 million. In fact, we believe we will put $3.2 million back into our fund balance, which is good news. And you can see how that has trended over the past several years, where we have budgeted $3.5 million and put $7.8 back. So we feel like this is a conservative use of fund balance based on our history of using it. Slide gives you a little bit of an idea of general fund revenue by source. So you can see that over half of our revenue comes from property taxes, and about a little over 18% comes from sales tax. So those make up the majority of our revenue. So I want to spend a little bit of time talking specifically about the Alamance County department budgets. We do have, just to give you an overview of personnel, again, I'll have some more slides and a little more details. We have new positions in the budget, several career ladders, and one reclassification. The total cost for personnel for county departments is $581,000. I'm recommending a market adjustment of 2%. That would be a 2% raise for all county employees. You see the cost of that is $943,000. We are covering with this budget the mandatory increase state retirement. We are also proposing to increase the funding that we give for our employee health insurance. We have been doing that for the past 2 years, and our auditors have encouraged us to continue to do that. The county department budgets also have capital outlay to the tune of a little over $1.1 million. I will go through those projects with you. We're also proposing to put $250,000 in the county's capital improvement plan. And we do have a radio project that I mentioned at the budget retreat. That would be $400,000, and I'll talk about that too. And our debt in the county budget, our debt payments total a little over $9.5 million. So just to go over personnel requests first, we're asking for a total of 13 new positions. You can see them broken down here, and I'll go over each one with you. We are recommending 2 career ladders, one for the county manager and legal department. These are for our clerks, as well as for the fire marshal's office. That career ladder is for our fire inspectors to get them in tune with our building inspectors and environmental health. And we're also recommending one position reclass our planner 1 to a planner 2 position. So the positions that we are proposing to fund with this budget include a delinquent tax collector in the tax department. This is a position that will help generate significant tax revenue. This is one that our funds put toward it will pay off with additional funds coming in through our collections. Environmental health, I think a number of the commissioners are aware of some of the delays we're experiencing, particularly with restaurant plan reviews. Environmental health has proposed that we add another person. I believe that wait, according to our environmental health director, is up to around 3 weeks to get your plan reviewed. We hope that this position should be able to cut down on that wait time. Our social services department, we are proposing 4 positions for social services, a processing assistant to help social workers. They're about to transition another one of their programs over to NC FAST. They will need that help. social worker to work after hours with family, and two economic service supervisors. This will help the Department of Social Services meet their timeliness and accuracy requirements that are coming down from the state, since DSSs around the state have had difficulties meeting those requirements. So, and all of these positions are cost shared. They have revenue tied to them from either the state or federal government. We are recommending a position for our cooperative extension. This is our family and consumer science agent. This will be some shared funding from the state. These are our ServSafe person that does health and food safety programs over at Cooperative Extension. We're also recommending a new fire inspector for the Fire Marshal's Office. Commissioners remember, last year we took away one of their positions to create the new Emergency Management Department, which has been very successful, but with all the increase in building and plan reviews, it has put our Fire Marshal's Office far behind in being able to meet all the inspections that they are required to do, as well as review all the plans that they're required to review. We're also looking at adding four paramedics in our Emergency Services Department. This will allow us to staff up a 12-hour peak time ambulance, and this will help us out tremendously. We run out of trucks middle of the day. That's our peak times for us to be out of units. We believe this will help us alleviate that pressure during the peak busiest times when we're doing emergency services as well as convalescent transport. And the final position that we're recommending is the Northern Park Manager for the Parks and Recreation Department. This position was recommended by county management when the Recreation Parks Department absorbed the Convention and Visitors Bureau. They did some internal shuffling, did some changing, and we told them at that time that we would propose at budget time for a position to come back to them that they moved to help manage the new load with the CVB. A little bit of information about equipment for county governments. We're $177,000 worth of general equipment. This includes new CPR units, automatic CPR units for EMS. They have one now. They'd like to put one on each medic unit. They have proved to be extremely popular in rushing them to the scenes of cardiac arrest, as well as outfit all of our ambulances with power stretchers. We would do that through a lease. Do some door locks, security works at the Family Justice Center, and backhoe attachment for the Recreation Parks Department for one of their tractors. We're recommending $118,000 in computer equipment. That includes $66,000 for MIS. That is for fire suppression, a fire suppression system over at HSC, where we have our new server room, as well as funding to do some upgrading to cameras and monitors in this space so we can have a better videotaping capability of these meetings and all the meetings that occur in this room. We're also proposing to spend $52,000 for 10 laptop computers for the Sheriff's Department. This is for their positions that they received in 16-17. And the final project here, $400,000 for us to replace Viper 800 megahertz radios that were purchased between 2008-2009. Those radios are reaching end of life. They need to be replaced. We have several hundred of them. We would like to put them on a technology lease. So this would be a lease payment that would come back, if it's approved, would come back before the board to approve the lease. But that is significantly less than trying to replace all of those at one time up front. The capital cost is, we feel, is much better to run it through a lease as we do our computer system for county government. Vehicles, we are recommending a new truck for maintenance, new truck for the Fire Marshal's Office. Inspections Department is requesting two Kia Souls. They found that those would be helpful for them to do their inspections, fuel efficient and economical, as well as ambulances for the EMS Department. That would include one for their new shift and two remounts and a replacement medic unit that is reached the end of its life. Other capital items and improvements for county government. This is all county government, let me remind you. $286,000 for the library for them to be able to purchase books and all kinds of other materials. And we have $170,000 of other improvements. This will be for our maintenance department. You know, we have a CIP plan for projects over $10,000. We have a number of projects that are under $10,000. We were putting some money in the maintenance department's budget. Includes HVAC projects, rooftop safety, and fire safety projects. Then the Recreation Parks Department would receive a little over $49,000 to replace flooring at Eli Whitney Gym down in the southern part of the county, as well as do restoration work to the Garrett Cabin out of Cedar Rock Park. Capital improvement plan for the county. I'm recommending a $250,000 allocation for our capital needs. This includes roofing needs. As you can see, I won't go through all the projects, but we have $129,000 worth of roofing needs ourselves, $40,000 worth of boiler and chiller replacements. paving needs. We need to put some concrete pads down at the EMS headquarters, $16,000, and replace some doors at the maintenance department, be another $16,000. We've included in this $250,000 costs for engineering, and these are estimated engineering costs, as well as estimated contingency for all projects. Other funds, our landfill, this is the capital request from the landfill, a little over $1 million for the landfill to buy two vehicles, a Bobcat and a new four-wheel drive F-250 truck, as well as most of that money, most of that $1,071,000 is going to be spent at the landfill doing the new access road and the double tails. That work's already begun. They've done some grading out there as a part of the timbering project. This access road and scales will allow the landfill to get very accurate weight readings on waste trucks when they're coming in and out, and be able to weigh them as they come in and then weigh them again when they come out, and the landfill staff feels like they will see a significant uptick in revenue annually from being able to do that. So, a little information about the debt service, what we foresee is debt for Alamance County. Our total outstanding principal, July 1 of this year, will be the $57.6 million that you see there. You can see how it breaks out in the graph. For the county, we have $4.7 million in debt for installment loans. For ABSS, we have a combination of bond debt and installment debt. Alamance Community College, we have bond debt. You can see that our payment that we are budgeting in 17-18 will be a little over $9.5 million. Of that payment, $1.9 million is for county installment debt, $5.6 million is for ABSS debt, and a little over $2 million is for Alamance Community College. And that new $2 million payment for Alamance Community College does include the very new $1.2 million debt for ACC's Applied Technology Center. So that funding is in here in the proposed budget too. And our legal debt margin, as you can see, is over $998 million. And that is according to our audit. So my recommendation for the Alamance-Burlington school system, for 16-17, their total funding was $38.5 million. Current expense for ABSS this fiscal year was $38.2 million. Capital outlay was $250,000. I'm recommending this year a total allocation for Alamance-Burlington school system of $41,181,907. That would give them, for their current expense, $40,681,907, and a recommended capital outlay of $500,000. That is a total recommended increase of $2,667,718 over what we allocated for the school system in 16-17. Alamance Community College, for 16-17, we recommended a funding level of $3,471,621. Their current expense is a little over $3 million, and their capital outlay is $440,000. Total recommended budget is, I'm recommending that we spend $3,663,202 for Alamance Community College. That would be a little over $3.2 million for their current expense, and would keep their capital outlay at $440,000. Total recommended increase for Alamance Community College, $191,581. Outside agency requests. I'm recommending a outside agency request budget of $4.2 million. And you can look on page 31 in your booklet, and it gives a specific breakdown. I did not put that in the slides. I figured you would want to look at that yourselves, and you can see what each agency is getting. Just to give you an idea, we're funding 21 different outside agencies. Two of these agencies are grant funds only, so they're a total of pass-through dollars. Six of the outside agencies are home care community block grant, and they're a combination of grants and county dollars that they use as match. That is a $1.1 million total. We have four agencies that are occupancy tax funded, and that is $678,000. And then the 10 other agencies that you'll find on page 31, the total funding for them is a little over $776,000. And then we also are including our maintenance of effort mental health funding in the outside agency pool. That is $1.2 million, as it has been for a number of years. If you remember, we have been in the past giving those funds to Cardinal Innovations. We're not going to do that anymore. We're going to contract directly with the provider, so next year they will become part of outside agency funding requests per provider instead of just mental health funding. I'm recommending two outside agencies not be funded at this time. Allied Churches, who had made $100,000 request. We are going to work with Allied Churches through the Department of Social Services. We hope to be able to use some contract dollars through DSS to give them some funding. And I'm also recommending that we not fund the Young Musicians of Alamance. You can see here a graph of the general fund expenses by function. Public safety gets 23.85% of the general fund expenses. Our human services get 23.5% of general fund expenses. This year, education will get a little over 30% of the total general fund expenses for Alamance County government. I'm just going to touch on the volunteer fire departments because we do have two volunteer fire departments with rate increases. That's the Altima Hall OSPE Volunteer Fire Department. They are with us this evening. Their current tax rate is 11¾ cents. They are proposing they go to 14 cents. The additional revenue they would see from this increase would be a little over $93,000 annually. E.M. Holt Volunteer Fire Department, they are proposing a tax increase to go from 10¾ cents to 11¾ cents. And the additional revenue that E.M. Holt Volunteer Fire Department would see is a little over $67,000.
Will those votes on the fire departments be a separate vote from the overall budget?
No, we have in the past incorporated those into the recommended budget. So if
we can adjust them.
Yes, if you choose.
At that point,
all the rest have maintained their flat rate. And that is a pretty quick overview of my recommended budget. I know we're going to vote here shortly, I believe, on relocating the next meeting and moving the time and relocating the meeting. But at this time, I will be happy to try to answer any questions that you may have.
I have a couple questions. So your recommended budget for Alamance Burlington school system is $6 million short of what was being requested.
Yes.
And the request was very specific about digital learning initiative, $600,000 almost, $750,000 in capital outlay, and a third of that, $250,000, was just for one item, and that was for the architect and engineering support that's necessary to do the proper planning on sizing and developing what the cost would be for a new high school, as well as renovations to existing needed refurbishments, expansions, renovations to existing schools, which is very necessary. I mean, everything in my view in their requested budget is necessary, but the big ones really deal with teacher pay supplements and building level employees, the classified employees. So the, for example, the teacher supplements alone is $1.6 million almost. The classified pay scale is almost $3 million. So this doesn't begin to touch any of that with just a $2.6 million increase.
Yes. Yes, we're about $5.7 million short of the total requested increase of $8.3 million.
Yeah, I estimated just about $6 million. Okay, and then and just to be clear about Alamance Community College, I think that one of their big requests had to do with replacing their heating and ventilating system.
Yes.
You're not recommending the funding of that, I guess.
I'm not. That was about a $1.3 million project, and that would be a little difficult to fit into our operating budget. What I would hope the community college, if this budget goes through as proposed, might consider that become part of possible part of their bond proposal. That's a pretty large project at $1.3 million. That would be more than we spend on about everybody's capital combined. It's a big project. I'm sure, and I know it's a need. I do indeed.
Well, the difficulty I have is that I know Alamance Community College is a separate organization and it has its own board, and Alamance Burlington School System is a separate organization and they have their own board. However, we're just as responsible for certain budgetary items in those two organizations as if they were our own. And I think that they ought to be given the same consideration that as though they were a regular county department. And I mean, those building needs are built, that's our responsibility. And teacher pay supplements are our responsibility.
I will say to the board that the $250,000 county capital improvement plan leaves, and I'm not proud to say this, $4 to $5 million in deferred capital that we're not addressing. I mean, that is a rather low amount of money.
So you're being consistent and under budgeting for
we're
our facilities
too. So. Yes.
I don't know if that's wise. If that's wise, I know that the school board is creating a 5-year, maybe longer, facilities plan. I don't know if we do, and I think that. That's something that we ought to be looking at.
We do. We do have a 5-year, not a facilities plan. We have a 5-year capital improvement plan.
Yeah, but we need a full assessment of all of our buildings. I agree. You got some money budgeted here in buildings. I'm not even sure if they're worth investing money in.
I agree.
And we need to have how many buildings do we have? 40 buildings?
40, yes.
And how many hundreds of thousands of square feet is that?
500,000 to 600,000.
Yeah. And I wonder how many of those square feet are really necessary if we were able to consolidate somehow into fewer buildings. Buildings designed for the purpose that we're using them for.
That would be ideal, yes. Yeah.
So, I mean, that's what we ought to be planning for long term.
I agree. Yeah.
Commissioner Byrd seems like he's troubled by the school board had requested approximately $8 million increase, right? Is that right? And they're getting 2.5.
They're getting approximately 6 less than what they requested.
Right. They had requested a 20% increase in their total budget, right?
I didn't calculate out the percentage. I'll take your word for it. But it's targeted.
That's what
it's not like it's
right. But that's what I recall from the budget presentations that I've seen. And this is right at 7%.
That's correct.
Increase for the ABSS budget, right?
Yes.
What was the percentage? Did you say?
Seven. Right.
No,
at seven.
I mean their request was
20.
20. So we're giving 7 instead of 20. Is that what your point is?
But they had asked for 20, but this budget is 7.
It's not like they pulled that out of the air. Like I said, it's very targeted.
No, I agree.
For specific purposes.
They did.
That will, which is what is going to take to achieve those metrics that are now stated.
Right. I got you.
Okay. What's the balance in our lottery account?
I've asked Susan to pull that up.
I want to say, commissioners, it is, give me just a minute, let me get that information for you. We had 3.6 that was available, and the school system, if you'll remember, had brought a request of 1.5, and then we had the recent Career Tech Center of $453,000. After all of that is approved, the lottery balance should be around $1.7 million.
With an annual dump in expected to be what?
About 1.5.
This fiscal year?
Yes, sir.
Eddie, wasn't that, didn't the legislature, did that bill get approved where they were going to increase the
They are supposedly going to increase the lottery funding for capital projects. But it's in the House now.
Yeah. Okay, so it hasn't gone through.
Right.
So the fiscal year 17-18
right.
Would be what?
Would be about 1.5 is what we have received the last few years, and they award that quarterly.
Okay. Now, of that total, what was it, 3.2?
Yes, sir.
Is that correct? What would we have that would have to come out of that in a designated fashion as far as our budget, theirs, they're asking for debt service? Or
The only thing that we have a memorandum of understanding with the school board is on the Career Tech Center. And that is for when the Career Tech was built, $130,000 was what the county decided that they would fund each year. So annually, I take that debt service payment, subtract that out, as well as the interest rebate that we received because of the qualified school capital building bonds that we use to fund that. And the balance is what we pull down from the lottery funds, and that changes every year.
So I would say that on their capital budget, they based their $750,000 request from us, considering that whatever they would be able to get from the lottery, plus another out of another capital revenue fund as well. In other words, the 750 already accounts for the other capital.
Budget.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. I had a, I guess, a remark or a question. I noticed that education is 30.48% of our budget in Alamance County. I wonder if you, or maybe Dr. Harrison knows, what's the average in North Carolina for a county to spend on education? For some reason, I have it in my head that it's 33% of a average county budget spent on education.
I'm not sure of that figure.
Can anyone address that?
Amy, is that 30% both ACC and ABSS?
No, yes, that was, that's an education.
It's both, yes.
Portion of our pie, right.
Well, that's also an important point. And I do think that we need to increase the percentage of the county budget that goes toward education over time, but I would stress over time, and that I would see not all happening in one year. But I look forward to looking through the things that you've presented tonight and having a couple weeks to think about it.
Certainly.
Brian, thank you so much for what you did. I know you come in on this kind of, Craig dumped it on you. I understand that. But you've done a good job on working with it the best you can. I think our job for the next couple weeks is to have some input, and we'll bring it back to our meeting and figure out where we need to go.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So if we want to provide suggestions, we want to funnel those through
it's still
you.
Still open.
You want to funnel those through you or write to Brian, or how would you like to handle it?
I would just suggest going through Brian at the time, because he and our finance director will actually put the numbers and can kind of help us out with that. So
one thing I would like to say, that I'm really pleased to see that, especially the family and consumer science agent back in the budget for the agricultural extension office. That's the position that's been vacant for 4 years, and I think that Mr. Danley told me that they had been contracting it out, but the person had retired, and so we didn't have anybody in the county through the ag department to give instruction on food preservation and food safety programs. And that's really one of, when you think of the history of the ag department, you think of the home extension agent teaching people how to take care of the food at home. So I'm really pleased to see that position is back.
Yeah, I think that was a needed position for sure. All right. Okay. Next on our order here is a request to change the June 5th meeting from here on a Monday morning to Historic Courthouse on a Monday night. So
I'll make the motion. We move.
Okay. Thank you, Bill.
A second.
Thank you, Amy. All in favor?
Aye.
All right, and next we need to set a public hearing for our budget, which we've just went through, and entertain a motion to do that.
I'll do that for the same night.
Make okay. Thank you, Bob.
Second.
Thank you, Amy. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, next we have our fire departments. I'm going to start with Ed from AO. I think you're first up, sir.
Thanks for the opportunity to come up here. Wasn't expecting David's speech, but since I just wanted to correct a couple things that he went over. He mentioned a balance of $174,000. That is an incorrect balance. That was the balance on our budget sheet as of 12/31 of 2016. We do receive a lot of our money between September and January. After that, we get trickle amounts, and the majority of that is from September 15th in that area to January, so that's why that balance was that of as of 12/31 of 2016. David did express some concerns about issues on the board, conflicts of interest. There has been a conflict of interest policy put in place, signed by each board member. There have been changes made on the board. He mentioned the treasurer being related to the former fire chief. She is no longer the treasurer and no longer is the bookkeeper. So those have been addressed. Also, we have had several board members change in the last year. To give everybody, I'm guessing you got the packet with all the information in. Okay. To kind of give some heads up, the AO Fire Department is seeking a 2.25 cent increase for the 2017-18 budget year. The reason for the biggest part of this increase is several capital outlay items that have not been included or planned for in the past. As David mentioned, we've had some administrative changes, and we're addressing these problems that have arisen in the past year or so. Some of these items were turnout gear replacement. That stuff has an average, well, it has a life on it of 10 years. After 10 years, NFPA says we have to replace it. Air bottles for the air packs, 15 years. That's some of the things that haven't been correctly planned for in the past and put a set amount every year as far as, you know, we need this much a year for 10 years, or we need to, have a schedule
right
to replace this stuff. I was elected chief in November, so I was kind of behind the eight ball on the budget, but myself and Justin have been working on a lot of these figures since probably May of 2016, when the former chief left us. This budget has been gone through meticulously through the bookkeepers, past transactions over the last couple of years. Anything that is not necessary has been taken out. Necessary stuff is there. Some of the things that I wanted to point out was the annual cost of replacing turnout gear to get on a schedule to meet those standards, air bottle replacements. One of the things that is in this year's budget that a lot of the fire chiefs that I've talked to were under the impression we were going to be next year is this radio replacement. We're looking at $100,000 and some change to replace part of our radios. I mean, we can't afford to do all of them on a 7-year lease purchase. If we go with the county, it saves us $15,000 plus. If we go out on our own, then we're going to be footing that bill, and that's just more expense. Truck fund, we have 4 trucks that are 20 plus years old. That allows for us to start planning on replacing some of these trucks. One of the things that David mentioned was, balances. Our capital reserve, we had a truck that had to have our engine replaced 2 years ago, cost $24,000. I'll put our capital reserve account up against any in the county on the fire side. I've been at the fire department 24 years, and in all those years, I can probably only remember one time we had over 60s, probably in the $60,000-$70,000 range in capital reserve. Right now, we're at around $54,000, $30,000 of that we can't touch per USDA stipulation of the loan we have on a truck. We have to keep one payment in capital reserve at all times.
Is that a yearly payment?
Yeah, once a year. That comes in May.
You have to hold that in your fund right. Balance, right?
Yes. Some of the history on this, I came in this in November. June of last year, the fire department had to take out a loan against one of their trucks to make payroll and bills through September. So we went into this budget year we're in right now in the hole from what they borrowed from capital reserve to make ends meet, plus the truck loan, and you're probably talking close to $100,000. And, you know, David said, where's the money going? Well, yeah, we had a tax increase back in 2014. In 2000, let me think of the date here. 2010, we got a grant for two personnel through FEMA. And that, it was set up on a five-year plan. You know, the government paid so much the first year, and then we had to share the cost the second year, and the third year, and the fourth year. The fifth year, we had to take on all that cost. That grant ended in 2015. That 1 cent increase that they got in 2014 wasn't enough to where we could keep, you know, kind of borrowing Peter to pay Paul. And it actually should have been probably a larger increase back then. We've been dipping into capital reserve year after year after year, and it finally caught up with us. One of the things we had to do June of 2016 was lay off personnel. We didn't replace the former chief when he left, and we had to lay off our part-time position, which provided coverage at our substation 8-5. One of the benefits of that substation, when it was put up there, some of the people in the northern end of the district saw savings on their homeowners insurance upwards of $1,000 a year. The budget I've presented is in no way enormous. It's what we need to operate. We're third in the county on fire calls, and we're number one in the county for mutual aid calls. We run a lot of calls mutual aid over to the university. We're the only county fire department that holds a heavy rescue certification. I talked to Amy before, she mentioned fundraisers, and the firemen have raised a lot of funds through businesses in our area to fund that. And that was not all taxpayer money. I mean, that was them, the guys getting out there doing fundraisers and, you know, talking to businesses, you know, help us out, and they have. We also have an ATV rescue unit that is available to anybody in the county if they request it. It has been to Hall River, Pleasant Grove, I'm thinking there's one other place. Does anybody got any questions? I guess y'all didn't get the...
Yeah, we got it in our packet. It's in our... I got it in my packet right here.
You got an extra copy?
Yeah. Well, I have it on the computer, okay, yeah, so you're welcome to have it.
What's your insurance, the rating? What is it when you're rated based
currently
on...
Currently, it is a 6. And that, when we were rated back in... started in 2012 and kind of finished... When they came in and rated us, we appealed their decision because one of the things they recommended was the substation, and we were down a truck at the time. The truck was ordered, but we were down that truck, so they came back with a 7 rating. We appealed it. We had 1 year to have that truck in place and the substation. So those things were done. When they came back in, we had a 6 rating. And we were 6 points away from a 5.
The lower is better, I tell you.
Yes, the lower you get, the better.
The better.
One of the things that, you know, in going through this paperwork was personnel. And back then, they recommended one more than what we had. They recommended another station, but that's, I mean, it's not feasible. But at that current time, back in 13, they recommended one more paid personnel during the day. We're down 2 right now.
Are you planning on hiring 1 or 2?
This budget that we're proposing is for putting that one person, that one position back at the substation.
Right.
And that's my biggest focus. Those people up there, when we laid off, they were not happy, and I'm sure maybe some of y'all heard about it.
I can understand why. When they get your insurance bill, they would.
But, you know, that's the biggest thing. They're scared it's going to affect their insurance rate, and there is a possibility it could. They judge us on everything. Training, calls, how many people we have on calls, personnel, hydrants, water sources. You know, it's a lengthy process, and they check everything.
Yeah, we appreciate what y'all do.
I appreciate it.
I know you took over that department, and that I know that that brought its own issues.
Yeah.
And the transferring and
it,
all that.
It has not been easy, and it has not been an ideal situation to have to take over in. You know, usually you like taking over when things are all on the up and up.
Right.
There have been some hard decisions made, but there have been a lot of people working to get us in the right direction. We've changed policies. We've changed how we do things. We're looking, saving money. I mean, we upgraded the lighting at the station through some incentives through Duke Energy. You know, it's little stuff like that we're working on to save money anywhere we can.
One of the things I understand from talking to you is that you had some unexpected employee costs with having to pay out vacation and sick time for people who left. Some comp time had been built up.
Right.
But y'all have changed your policy so that those kind of things won't happen anymore.
We had an employee that was terminated in December of 15. We had one that left for other employment in March of 16. And then we had the former chief left in May. Those employees were owed comp time, vacation time, stuff like that. And one of the employees had comp time that was built up for 6 or 8 years. So when you got somebody that has that many hours built up, that's a hit if you haven't stuck that money back.
Right.
We have changed our policy on comp time to where we can't build up any, pretty much like the county policy. You know, the board came up and said we need to change policies. We want to try and go after, you know, the county, see what the county's doing, see what other fire departments are doing. You know, we looked at Mebane, I think Hall River, and some of the other city fire departments. We looked at the county's policy, and we kind of tailored it after that. You can't build any more than 40 hours worth of comp time, and it has to be taken within that month. Mm-hmm. Unless it is, you know, an emergency, and that has to be approved through the station manager. And if it's long-term, it has to be approved through the board.
So in 2016, y'all had quite a few things that happened at the fire department that were not really anticipated.
Right.
With capital needs. Right, and then these personnel matters and things. And so you came in November and had to try to start sorting it out?
Yeah, pretty much. I kind of got smart and got on the up and up and started about May, June, because I knew the way things were going in that it was going to change again. Mm-hmm. And so I told them we need to find out where we're at, where we need to go, and we needed a plan. And, you know, we started working on that pretty much June of last year.
Go ahead.
When the board was out trying to secure a loan for a truck to make payroll.
Right. Is there any kind of training that you know of that's offered for fire chiefs in how to budget, budgeting training?
There is some. You know, we have to have chief 101 class to be a fire chief. That's a certification. That touches on a little bit of budget stuff. I think a lot of the chiefs in the county, it's experience based.
Right. I was wondering if maybe that'd be something, a vacuum that maybe the county could step into, if the chiefs would be interested in kind of getting together and maybe sharing war stories about this is what we had to do.
Work through issues.
Through issues and sharing that.
I'm
and then also having, you know, somebody from the county to say this is how. This is a way to approach budgeting.
Right.
If you think, or the other chiefs think, that would be a useful undertaking.
There's, you know, I've talked to one. We have chief conference every year, and we go to Charlotte and have chief conference. And we learn a lot of stuff like that.
That's one of the things, you know, I've thought of, you know, and I've talked to Mark too, you know, is taking advantage of stuff like that. You know, if the county offers something, I'd be all in it, you know.
Yeah.
Something
local,
not expensive,
well.
Not like a big, you know, catered thing.
This is a profession, you know.
Just,
if you're not
right,
you can't
afford that in your budget.
Learning, then it's time to find
something
that
we can help you to do your job
right.
Right.
better, and maybe something about purchasing. I don't know if there's training about doing purchasing.
Or collaboration between the departments to maybe saving money in some places.
Things like that.
Give it the fire marshal's office, maybe give it the chief council.
Well, that's the issue I've always asked about, the fire marshal's office. Okay, two years ago, best of my memory, the last thing I voted on, I came out to AO, and we didn't you do a concrete slab replacement or something out there?
Well, that was probably in the substation up there, because that was total.
Fawcett did.
But I remember when Drew Sharp was our, was that his name? Going back a long time. He was, wasn't he our fire marshal?
Yes.
Yeah, and I was always wondering, you know, concerned, how much hands-on does the fire marshal have to go out and look at each individual department and see if their equipment appears to be enough or not enough, or the budgets appear to be too high, too low? Does the fire marshal have any involvement at all?
Not other volunteers.
I know they test equipment and for them and help them test ladders and pumps. And
right, they do that for them, save them a substantial amount of money. But as far as budgets, they got their own executive board and board of directors handle money. We don't touch money. That would be a contract situation.
I think one thing I forgot to mention, their proposed rate, 2.25% increase, would cost a $200,000 property, roughly $40 a year.
But the folks up in the other section or your other station will recognize a lot more saving than that, I'm sure.
We did have an annual meeting. It was posted social media on the marquee and on the website. And for the record, there was no opposition at that meeting.
To changing the rate?
Correct. And one person was specifically asked if he had a rejection to it.
Now, you do know this will put you the highest in the county, too.
I know. I realize that.
Okay. Just wanted you to know.
With that being said, you know, I came into a situation, and I have worked, Justin has worked, is looking at expenses over the past years, and this budget has been researched a lot, and it's what we need, and I hope y'all will consider it.
All right.
For the fire department and the people out in our district we protect.
Let me just ask one more quick question. You mentioned fundraisers.
Mm-hmm.
And you mentioned that your firemen were going out and soliciting donations from the community. Is mm-hmm. that right? And then you'll have your tractor pull.
Yeah, the September 23rd, everybody please come out.
I hear the fireworks real good.
Really good.
And I attended that last year. We didn't stay for the fireworks, though. It's too hot.
You missed
it. But what about, I think that Eli Whitney, they have a couple of breakfasts. I don't know how feasible it is to really raise the kind of money that you're talking about with the tax increase.
Right.
But has your board, instead of putting it off on the firemen, has your board considered doing some more fundraisers?
That was something I was going to address with them at their next board meeting.
Okay.
Yeah.
We talked about that.
And you have a large board too, as Dave mentioned.
Yeah.
So.
Put them to work.
Yeah. I mean, it's hard these days because I know I headed up the tractor pull thing last year, and it's hard to raise any substantial money. I mean, you know, the tractor pull, you know, you're talking liability-wise going into it, $20,000.
Right.
You know, and last year we raised somewhere around $12,500.
Right. At least y'all have a good facility for doing something like the breakfast, because it's a good building.
With that up in the air right now, we don't know if we're going to have it next year, you know. Pending sale on the racetrack up there. I talked to the owner, he gave us permission, but if somebody sells it and they develop it and put houses there.
I'm sorry, I meant the actual building where y'all are, the AO Community
breakfast.
Center.
Yeah.
For breakfast, y'all got that. I went to breakfast at Fawcett, and they were struggling with space and so forth. I don't think North Central has
y'all
any kind of facility like that, so y'all have the space to be able to.
I'm interested. I like bacon and eggs.
Yeah, me too. I'll be there.
All right.
We'll venture down there.
All right. Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Next, Mark with EM Hope Fire Department. I don't know what it is tonight, Tim. Both of these are hitting me because I got a house in this one and one of it there. So, y'all
this
ganging,
is your problem,
up, ganging right? up.
Make sure you this tell is your problem. House in HR.
Yeah.
Hello, I'm Mark Fuquay. I've been in the fire service 35 years, been fire chief 17, the M. Hope Fire Department. And what brings me here tonight is a 1 cent increase. And the reason we're having that 1 cent increase is when our budget began, we received a copy from, it was Andrew Rollins, that we were to use our last year's budget. So I called a board meeting together and that's what we done, which was $691,000. So, and I contacted Ms. Rollins, told her we wouldn't be able to turn our budget in until the 15th of March, until the 7th, because I had to get my tax board 2 weeks notice before we had it. So in that time, Mr. Atkins sent me a budget sheet. And what happened with that budget sheet, our numbers went down. It went down, we lost $77,000. In revenue. So that put us at 614, the number. Our numbers have been so far back and forth. Kind of got messed up on them. So I called my board meeting again and told them that we lost 77,000. So that's when they decided to do a 1 cent increase, which in the time being, which that put us at 11.75. After that, I received some more numbers from Ms. Rollins, which the number was $603,720,000. At 10.75, that put us at $648,000. At 11.75, it put us $709,000. And that's what our total budget is at this time. On March the 15th, I had a tax board meeting. I presented it to the tax board. They approved it 100%. We opened our meeting. No one showed up at our meeting to contest it. And the reason we're asking for one increase, we're trying to build a station. Been trying to do it for years. I went out and worked and worked and worked, and I got 10 acres of land donated to us from Ms. Schaffner. So that gave us a big start. So we're looking at around 2 years. If we lose this money, it's possible we could put it back 5 years. And the reason we put it back 5 years, we have a radio problem too. We got the $160,000+ in radios we got to buy this year that we didn't think we were going to have to buy. And in the fire service, let's see here. This thing's kind of new to me. So. In the fire service, my budget's not about an increase. It's about maintaining. We need to try to maintain what we have because high cost of insurance, workers' comp, turnout gear. Everything we deal with has an expiration date on it. All our EMS stuff, all our radios, fire trucks. NFPA says that we have to 20 years on our trucks, 10 years on turnout gear. All our EMS stuff expires every year. I spend $1,200 to $1,400 a month, well, a year on EpiPen that we don't ever use, but we have to have them. Like I said, our big thing is the radios and the substation that we're trying to build for the community. This would save the people that live outside our 7 miles pay a class 10. So you're looking at several thousand dollars a year, because I got some $1 million homes that live in that, it's just in that area. So we've been hit hard. I get phone calls every day about when we're going to build a station. So we finally got the 10 acres. We finally put the sign up on the 10 acres. So I'm committed to building this station for these people. And if we keep going backwards and have to try to build back up, well, we got no chance of even. I know every time I've ever had to come to you is because I've been cut. Now, the city hurt us real bad. Y'all wasn't involved in
it.
Yeah, we lost a lot of money. And we finally got our budget to back where it needed to be. And to look at it and have a cut like that. I think it ended up after we got our last numbers like at 42,000. And I looked at his increase like of 67,000, and all we had like an $18,000 increase. So our numbers have jumped back and forth, and it's been hard to kind of figure it out. But we do know that a penny would get us at 709 is what we're looking at. I know the, I think the paper is like 721, but 709 is where it would put us if we do our penny with the last numbers I received. So I had three meetings with our board back and forth before we ever come to a decision, and then we went to the tax board. So that's what I'm here for. I'll keep it short, it's getting late. But if I got any questions.
What's your fund balance as right now?
We got right at 800 and some thousand dollars in total savings. 100,000 of that we can't touch because it's Fireman's Relief Fund. We have 10,000 in money that we've raised, but part of that has been set aside for years to build a substation. So we have saved some money, but the way we save it is I do all the maintenance work, and I'm teaching my guys to do that too. So we don't do anything unless it's real bad. We do our electrical, plumbing. We even got a guy that does heating and air for us. I got a new guy that does a lot of truck work. Anything big, we send it out. So we really saved our money doing that. But I hate to get punished because we work so hard to save it and we get cut. That's why I'm trying to keep our budget at the same.
So what's this new station going to cost you?
We're looking in maybe around five something. We're not building nothing real, and it may be less than that. I'm just throwing a number out there, but I hadn't really got started on it. We got the land. We just ended up getting it surveyed so we can start doing a little clearing. But I'm not going to build anything elaborate. I'm going to build three bays to put three trucks. I purchased one truck. Got to have two trucks to put in that station. We bought one truck. We're waiting to get another one paid off before we buy another one. That's what we've staggered our payments. We don't buy anything until we get it paid off. But turnout gear, I was listening to him about his turnout gear. That is a must. We cannot let people go over with bad turnout gear, air packs. We can't do it.
And state checks those every
well,
year.
Well, so if somebody dies, it'll shut the station down.
Yeah.
So that's pretty much. You know, if I got any questions, I'd be glad to answer them.
Well, hurry up and get that station going. That's all.
I mean, we're. I'm looking at 2 years, and that's getting the plans, and I moved along better than what we thought we were. Like I said, I went out my time and went out pretty much begging, and I happened to run into Miss Schaffner one day, and I went looking for a water point, and I got to tell her, she lives outside, she's got one of those $2 or $3 million homes, and lives out in the class 10. And a class 10 is you got no fire protection at all. So I got to talking to her, and she said, sure, you use my phone. Well, she called me 2 weeks later and said, I got 10 acres of land. So it's perfect. I don't know if you don't live out that way anymore, but
well,
it's on Beaver Creek.
House, so I hope
it's on Beaver Creek.
The next 2 years.
And Brick Church is at the corner there. And so we were fortunate, and that moved me. That put me several years ahead. But we've been talking about this for probably 10 years now. But we just hadn't had the money to do it. And I don't want to put ourselves in a point where we can't afford to do it.
Or you have to use those.
So I've been moving step by step, making sure we have stuff paid off. And so when we go into it, because I'm going to have to hire people to man it. Because my volunteer status is weak. You're talking about doing fundraisers. We tried it. We've done one this weekend. We made $180. Mm-hmm. So you can't, and we planned, we probably spent more than that getting ready for it. Mm-hmm. But that's all we took in. You can't count on people, and it's hard to get the volunteers to do anything anymore.
Right.
So it's this, and I've been in his shoes before. 17 years ago, I took over Emhoff Fire Department that was in the Sparrow going down, and I brought it a long ways.
I've been watching you for years, and you one of the best.
I really worked hard, and I appreciate that. That makes me feel good. I really worked hard, and I've dealt with these guys, and to bring it where we're at. I don't want to see us have to go backwards. I appreciate everything y'all do for us.
Now, what's your rating out there? I hate to dwell on that.
My ISO rating? ISO. We're a 7. Mm-hmm. And the reason we're a 7, at one time, we had the biggest fire district in the county. We had the airport, the industry. And what happened to us, the same thing that happened. When they come in, they said, this is what you need, the substation. And I needed a ladder truck and 4 more trucks. Well, I couldn't afford to do it. But that's the reason we're 7, because we didn't have enough stuff to provide to get down. We hope that we're ready now for at least a 5 when they come around. And I like to try to get the station up there before we ask them to come around. And that's what we're looking at. You know, you don't never know. The system has got a little better. The ISO system, they're coming in rating. Used to take, my first day on the job was I had to go through ISO. It took a whole week. But now they can do it like a day or two. They really got it down. And if you got your stuff together, it rolled right on through.
Are any of our departments at these levels, 5? Anybody know?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we've had.
Devin's a 3.
How low can you go?
1.
You
go to a 1.
Actually, a 1.
Anything below a 5.
Greensboro is a 1, but it takes a lot to get to
the 1. Yeah, it takes a lot of money.
You don't have many 1s around.
Probably do a 3 or 5, probably 3 inside the city where you have water supply.
Mebane's 3 inside the city, 5 outside the city.
Okay, because we had a guy from Mebane come speak to us, 3 years ago, 2.5 years ago?
Tim Bradley.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Anything below a 5, if you get to a 5, anything below that, you don't help any residential at all. You get into industry.
Okay.
That's really where they pay off, is when you go below that 5. That's what really gives them that big hit, is when, if you can get below that. Any of the volunteer fire departments in the county will never go. Some of them have got to a 5. Because the rating system has changed a little bit, has made it a little bit easier. But as far as below a 5, it'll be hard.
Now,
if you got to be on a hydrogen system and have pressurized hydrogen water to get anything lower than that. We're half and half. We worked hard. We've got a wet hydrant, which is a pond. We've got one about every mile now. So that's something that we tried. That's what ISO wants. So we've been good and fortunate in getting our water points in. Like I said, I just don't want to go backwards. I'd like to see us keep going forward.
Thank you, Mark.
All right, thank
what you.
You
do.
Uh-huh.
Appreciate
thank,
it.
Thank you.
All right. Next on our agenda tonight, we have a resolution to approve or not approve the sale of a property on Turrentine Street by County Attorney. If you want to come and fill us in on the details, sir.
We have received an offer from National Agents Alliance several weeks past for the purchase of 1.25-acre tract, which is right across the street from their office. The best time to sell a piece of property is when somebody wants to buy it. So they have offered $38,500, and I would recommend to you that you take this offer through the upset bid process.
What's that piece of property worth?
We had an appraisal made on it, and it's an appraisal of $45,000. But the way the legislature set this system up, when you go through an upset bid process, you put it out there for anyone that wants it to bid on it. And at any time, this board can decide it doesn't want to sell. If you don't think 38.5 is enough and you don't get any other bids, you don't have to sell it. But if you go through the process, and we'll put an ad in the newspaper, and we'll ask the national agents folks to put $1,925 in our hand, which is a 5% deposit. And then it'll go into the upset bid process, and any upset bid will have to exceed that by 10%. And it's a 10-day period, and you can receive one upset bid, you might receive 10, you might receive none. And after the time period runs, then I'll bring it back to you and ask if you want to sell it. Yes, sir.
Why don't we just counter offer for the appraised value?
Well, we could enter into a private sale, negotiated bid process, if that's the board's wish. The negotiated bid, I found, in my experience, puts it out for anyone in the county that may want to buy it. Remember, we've got Ralph Scott and Lifespan on either side of this property, so they may decide they want to purchase it. But that's up to the board. If you want to go this route.
Basically, what we're doing, we're starting at 38.5 as what Keith and his group has offered. And if someone else wants this property over and above that, then they can bid on it with the county.
But if we don't get any other bids, then I'll come back before the board and ask you if you desire to sell it for 38.5. So you get to vote on the final.
Well, can we at that time say to the proposed buyer, we'd like to sell it to you for the appraised value?
I think right now they know that they may have to go up a little more than 38.5, having heard your comments. But sure, you can do that.
Who pays for the advertising for the upset bids?
I've got that in my legal department budget.
So it's not added to the sale price? It's not something that, like, you know, tax foreclosure, I think the cost of the advertising the property for tax foreclosure is added to the sale price for the property?
Yes, as is the attorney's fees and court costs.
Right, but this is not like that. This would be coming out of our sale proceeds.
Right. Russ, correct. That's correct. Be about $300, I think.
And what about the title work and all that?
That's up to the buyer if he wants to have title insurance. If he wants to have a title and search time, we're going to sell it through a quitclaim deed, which is what the county normally conveys property through, and I'll do the deed.
You draft it too? So they get advertising and they get a deed drafted for them.
And they're at risk that someone may come in and say, I'd rather have that property. Make a parking lot.
That's anybody that you know of contacted Ralph Scott, the adjoining landowners, to let them know specifically that there's been an offer?
We divided that property. It was a single parcel. We divided it into three parcels in 2014, I believe it was, Brian. Mm-hmm. We sold the property to Ralph Scott and to Lifespan at that time. They did not express interest in that parcel at that time.
At that time. But we haven't let them know. Somebody wants to buy it now. This is the offer. Do y'all want to make an offer?
I can contact them directly. That's the board's wish. And they'll know. Notices in the paper. And this meeting tonight, we'll put them on notice as well. But it's totally up to the board to decide. And as I said, at any time, the statute would allow you to decide you're not going to sell it. So this is just step one. This is not the final decision made before you enter into an agreement to sell.
And if we suggested that we wanted, you know, if we had a counteroffer of $45,000, since that's what our appraisal supports, and the prospective buyer agreed to that, it would still have to go through an upset bid process. It would still have to be advertised and go through an upset bid process.
Advertise, and then we'd put it out for an upset bid. And whoever ultimately went through that process, you'd have to upset about at least 10% of that price.
Couldn't it be also negotiated that the prospective buyer pays for the advertising and pays for the drafting of the deed and all of that? They could reimburse the county the customary attorney's fees for drafting a deed.
Well, normally it comes out of the proceeds of the sale, our advertising costs. If we're going to go into a private negotiated sale with them, that'd be something we could talk about. But this process, the reason I recommend this process is because it puts out there in the market.
Yeah, I mean, that would be my feeling to proceed as you've outlined it.
Yes. And we have some other, I'll go ahead and tell the board now, we have some other buyers interested in other county properties that have expressed interest to me. Woody Drive and the Kernodle Building, which I'll develop further and bring to you when it's appropriate. I don't have written offers from Kernodle yet. I have talked to a person that's interested in purchasing that.
Good. That's good.
Mm-hmm. And that person will be using it for nonprofits. And I've talked to the manager about it. We're in the really, really early development stages right now of that conversation. And the person that indicated interest in purchasing that property has also indicated they would be willing to rent space to other nonprofits to free up more county space. So I would ask that you consider the resolution, and if you approve it, we'll go ahead and place the ad in the paper and get this process started.
I'll move that we do that.
Okay, thank you, Bill. Do I hear a second? Thank you, Tim. All in favor of moving forward with this?
Aye.
Everybody?
Thank you.
Okay, thank you, sir. All right. County manager, you've spent it tonight.
Two quick items. One, I'd like to ask the board to consider with the sale of this property that you consider the possibility of allowing us to use the proceeds of the sale after we clear any costs incurred during the sale to put toward helping us do an actual facility plan. You know, this is money that we've not planned on, we've not looked for, that's coming from the proceeds of the sale. Whatever we actually wind up with, you don't have to decide that now, but I'll put that out there for you to consider. We don't have money budgeted for next fiscal year to pay for anybody to come in and help us do some facility planning. It would be very helpful to be able to use some of this money to do that. So I'll put that out there. We'll talk about it once the property sells, but I'd like for you to consider that.
I think that's a good idea, so that's why we need to raise the price.
maybe Keith can help us out with that.
The second item.
Tonight, I'll raise it.
Okay. We got to go through the process.
It would be helpful to be able to use that. Second point I wanted to mention was I'd like to thank the sheriff and his department. Accompanied them on a trip to Washington, D.C. to the Police Week festivities up there, the National Law Enforcement Memorial. It was quite a moving experience to see close to 30,000 law enforcement officers from all over the country there, families of 143 officers that died around the United States this past year. Their families were there, escorted in by police, had program presentations by John Ashcroft and Jeff Sessions. It was just really, really good. And I will tell you, the Alamance County Sheriff's Department folks represented Alamance County very well. They looked very sharp and were most professional, and it was just really a proud time to be up there with them, well representing the county. So I appreciate the opportunity to go. Thanks to the sheriff and his folks for taking. I think Michelle is up there now and has been sending back tweets and Facebook posts.
The sheriff's still there.
No, he's returned.
Oh,
he's
okay.
Back.
So, just check.
And that's all that
did
I
did you give a picture?
No, we were not able to stop for your picture, but it was just well represented the county. So that's all I have.
All right. Any commissioner comments? Well, it's been a nice long meeting. Thank y'all for being civil, and thanks for you folks staying around. And with that, we will be adjourned.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is at 9 a.m. and the second meeting of the month is at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on Time Warner's Public Access Channel on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month at 10 p.m. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information about watching meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions regarding the content of commissioners' meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about the County Commissioners. You can send mail correspondence to the Commissioners by sending it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.